What a celebration of American motorsports. Indianapolis Motor Speedway crossover weekend. IndyCar kicked things off yesterday with Scott Dixon getting the win. Then the NASCAR Xfinity Series finished up Saturday with Ty Gibbs kissing the bricks. Now time to cap off the triple header with the NASCAR Cup Series on a gorgeous Sunday afternoon here at the racing capital of the world. Welcome everyone to Countdown to Green presented by Sonic from Indianapolis. What a weekend it's been so far. Now time for the Cup guys to take their turn and a shot to kiss the bricks here at IMS with playoff pressure looming as well. Hi everybody, Marty Snyder along with the Hall of Famers, Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Dale Jarrett, the man who invented kissing the bricks, and our buddy from IndyCar, James Hinchcliffe. We're honored to have you here, Hinch. Is there a better celebration of motorsports in America than this weekend?
I mean, I can't think of one, guys. You got the two top series in North America. You got the greatest racetrack in the world. Every driver loves coming here, but I think the real winners are the fans. I mean, how cool is it to get all the stars of open wheel, all the stars of stock car here in the same place? Like I said, one of the best tracks to come race at. When you drive through this tunnel, it's just such a special feeling for all these drivers.
Yeah, guys, you know, as racers, we want to race everywhere. But we want to win at special places like Daytona and right here at the most famous racetrack in the world, Indianapolis Motor Speedway. And at the end of this day, somebody, yeah, is going to get to kiss the bricks, but that celebration in Victory Lane is long unlike any other you'll experience. So somebody's looking forward to a great afternoon and a great finish to their day.
Yeah, racing at Indy is amazing, but this road course is challenging. It's got all kinds of problems for these drivers, especially getting down into turn one. On restarts, we've seen a lot of trouble here. We'll have to wait to see if that continues today. A lot of braking zones at this racetrack. Turn 7, turn 11, they're difficult to get into, especially turn 11. The car's hiking up the right front tire. You can lock the rear tires up in these next gens. We're going to see a lot of problems for these drivers throughout today.
Well, Junior, the man stealing all the headlines in the Cup Series lately is Chris Buescher. Back-to-back wins for Chris Buescher, but can he keep it going at a road course?
Oh, man, I like this guy, but it's tough to say three in a row is going to happen. I mean, I'll say this, though. He's finished 10th and 12th in his two races here. He's very good on the road courses, but I think he gets another top 10. There's just so much talent and speed in this race. It's going to be tough for whoever wins it.
Well, the NASCAR Cup Series hasn't turned left and right since the streets of Chicago a few weeks ago. On that day and night, a new NASCAR star was born. So who exactly is Shane Van Gisbergen? Our lead if he sat down to find out.
Welcome to the NASCAR Winners Club by
Huey Brand. Shane Van Gisbergen, the New Zealand driver, wins.
You have wowed people because of this significant accomplishment. Coming in on debut, boom, win.
That's so cool.
So you win Chicago, you make it back to Victory Lane. Take us from there.
Well, even before Victory Lane, when I did the burnout on the front straight and everyone just ran onto the track. Normally not allowed at home and we're pretty safety conscious. So here it was just let loose. It was awesome.
We talk about V8 supercars and what they do differently. We're going to take a look.
You amazed people by what you were doing with your feet.
Yeah.
Tell us more.
Oh, I don't know what to tell. It's normal to me. Always right foot brake and heel toe. It's what I've grown up doing. I guess they don't do it here anymore.
Some people think he's doing it for a competitive advantage.
That was a clinic. He made us look really, really bad. He's going to go home and tell all of his friends how bad we are.
He made us look like a bunch of fools. A foreigner came in and kicked our butt today, so we got work to do.
You kind of let the cat out of the bag a little bit after Chicago, where you said there's a definite endpoint to my supercars career. Why here? Why Trackhouse? Why now?
Yeah, like I've obviously achieved a lot of stuff there, and I was pretty happy staying in supercars all my life. But getting this opportunity with Trackhouse and Project 91, and then going as well as we did, like maybe next year or hopefully next year, I'll be here having a go.
Well, SVG is just part of the international flair to the race today, DJ. How surprising is it to see all the international interest in the Cup Series?
Never in my life did I thought we would see something like this. And, you know, the countries that are represented, 7 of them, it's not like we just went out and got 7 people. The yeah. List of accomplishments is incredible. We have champions, race winners, have done so much across the world in motorsports, but they wanted to come here and be a part of this day at the Brickyard.
So that list you're talking about, DJ, I mean, look at that. I mean, the field is stacked with some of the best drivers in the world. Hinch, my question is why? Why is the Cup Series all of a sudden the apple of every driver's eye?
I think it's easy. I think it's this new car. You know, the old Cup car was such a unique animal. It was very difficult to jump into and immediately be competitive. You guys know, drivers don't like driving in a new series if they don't think they got a chance at winning. This new car, it's closer to GT cars, closer to touring cars you see all over the world. So I think it gives drivers the confidence that they can jump in and immediately be quick.
We also got to remember, we're at Indy. If you're a race car driver of any kind, your dream is to come here and compete, if not try to win races. That's absolutely something every driver wants on their resume, so that's a big draw as well.
So, DJ, the question is, can one of the international superstars do what SVG did at Chicago today here at Indy?
Boy, he set the bar pretty high, didn't he, just a few weeks ago? But realistically, any one of them, because they're so talented and they're all in good cars, have that opportunity if things work out right. But my answer is no, it's not going to happen. I think the Cup guys are going to take over this race today and do everything right, and we'll see one of our regulars win.
Honestly, I think it could happen. I'm going to go the other way. Now, SVG specifically has lost his advantage of nobody knowing the track. The regulars know it here, so it's not as big an advantage. But he's got a race under his belt. He's got a race win under his belt. It could happen.
I want them all to run well.
I know you do.
I want more of them to come back.
You said in the booth you're going to be watching them all day long.
That's right.
So, yeah, no doubt about it. The crossover weekend showing up in so many ways, including former Indy 500 winner Tony Kanaan taking Kyle Busch for a ride in the IndyCar two-seater. Afterwards, Kyle admitted, "I'm not a very good passenger, but I enjoyed the ride." Meanwhile, the driver replacing Tony Kanaan for Arrow McLaren next year in the Indy 500 is Kyle Larson. Larson's livery for the 2024 500 was unveiled this morning a moment ago. Kyle Larson caught up with Jeff Burton.
Yeah, that's right, Marty. We're with Kyle Larson. Kyle, you're a once-in-a-generation talent. You win in everything you sit in. You won last night in the Knoxville Nationals. Now you're taking on the Indy 500. Tell us why.
It's been a dream of mine to compete in that event, and I've wanted to do it for a while. I just wanted to wait till the timing was right, and I feel like now's a good time. You know, I feel like I'm in my prime. I feel like our race team, our Cup team, is a consistent contender for the playoffs. So I feel like I can take a little bit of focus away from the Cup stuff for a month next year and trying to accomplish something pretty neat. So I'm looking forward to the opportunity with Arrow McLaren and Rick Hendrick and Hendrick Automotive Group. But we'll see. It's gonna be it's tough. I understand how tough it's gonna be, and trying to learn a totally new race car, a totally different style of racing. I think they have new hybrid stuff next year too. So there's gonna be a lot that I gotta learn, but I look forward to the challenge. I feel like I've prepared myself, through other challenges that I've, gotten in to try and learn new cars. So definitely excited about it.
Well, Marty, if anybody can do it, it's this guy right here.
Yeah, Hinch, you have an interesting perspective on this. You were Kurt Busch's teammate when he pulled the double, the last driver that tried to do it. What'll be Kyle Larson's biggest challenge in doing that next year?
Yes, everything. I don't think there's anything that's not going to be challenging about this. But here's the benefit he's got. And I got to see Kurt Busch do it up close and personal. I was his teammate at Andretti Autosport back in 14. Very impressed with how he approached the whole thing. And this is the important thing for Kyle. He's got time. Right? You think of all these other things he does that he jumps into that he mentioned. He's going to sprint car races. He's got four laps of practice and then straight into the heats. He's going to have thousands of miles of testing, practice, get to go through it all. So be slow, be methodical, build up to it. Lean on your teammates, lean on your engineers. And if he takes that slow and steady approach come race day, I think he's going to be just fine.
Yeah, and I think everybody needs to appreciate the undertaking in terms of off-track stuff. Just today, unveiling the car for the Cup Series and the IndyCar, doing that extra interview. Everything he does as a race car driver outside the car is going to quadruple. So all of his time is going to be tough to manage.
Yeah, and this young man, Kyle Larson, might be the most talented driver that we've seen come through this, able to win in anything and everything. Not saying he's going to come here and win next year. I know exactly how hard that can be, but he's going to be competitive, I feel sure.
So, DJ, throughout the race today, Hinch is going to hang out with you. But he asked me if he could kind of get out of here because he wants to check out the Cup cars, see them up close and personal. So this is goodbye for now, or
this
what?
This is goodbye. I'm going to go see if anybody left any keys in these things. There's a couple of nice-looking rides. I might see if
make
I fit in
the coordinate
seat.
With DJ where you guys
he might change this suit for a real suit.
Yeah, that's what worries me. We need you for the race. Don't leave us, Hinch, okay? All right, when we come back, the bubble battle, certainly the talk here in the NASCAR Cup Series. Time running out for some drivers, including that young man, Chase Elliott. We'll talk about the NASCAR Cup Series bubble next. NASCAR Drive is your live race day companion. Follow your favorite drivers with access to their in-car cameras. Choose from alternate camera angles. You can customize your entire streaming experience. Just visit NASCAR.com/drive or download the NASCAR mobile app to watch all the action. Look at those cool drone shots. You'll see them throughout the afternoon here from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway Road Course. Here's what's on the menu presented by Sonic this week. Front Row Motorsports announced they have exercised their 2024 option for both Michael McDowell and Todd Gilliland. They will be back in the 34 and 38 cars next season. To kick off the crossover weekend, Scott Dixon was in victory lane for IndyCar, and then Ty Gibbs for the NASCAR Xfinity Series later Saturday afternoon. And today, the Cup Series takes their turn with Daniel Suarez on the pole for Trackhouse Racing. The first job for Suarez today, survive Indy's treacherous turn one.
As a hardcore Indianapolis Motor Speedway fan, they could have a foot race and I'd want to win it.
Yeah! Let's go!
We see a five wide banging into each other left and right.
Turn one's crazy. We all come piling in there because it's the best chance you can have to make up spots on the racetrack.
It's a long wide straightaway and then it's a really sharp narrow turn, funneling us all into two lanes.
Calamity corner in turn one.
Those restarts going into one, you're looking in your mirror, trying to just be prepared for a bump or a stack up if something goes wrong behind you.
You just won at
Indy. Every single guy behind you is trying to outbrake you, and you're trying to outbrake the guy in front of you, and the next-gen cars don't get a lot of damage in general, so there's no penalty now to beat and bang.
Have you seen down there? I don't want to miss it, too. It's a mess down there.
Hopefully that chaos will be a little bit better today with the restart zone moved back for the race. But DJ, you might want to take a picture of these playoff standings because they will change by the end of the day.
Yes, they will. So everybody in the yellow, gold there, all they're looking for are stage wins and race wins, trying to get more playoff points. But the others that we see there battling for their life to try to be a part of the playoffs, and we've got a lot of names that aren't accustomed to having this type of pressure. How do they handle it here this afternoon?
One driver with a real chance to win his way into the playoffs over the next 2 weeks is two-time road course winner AJ Allmendinger. A moment ago, he caught up with Kim Coon.
A lot of eyes on AJ Allmendinger and this team this weekend. So how does pressure factor in to what you have to do here today?
For me, the pressure always kind of comes from within. We got the Dyna-Gross seed. Chevy was good in practice. We just missed it in qualifying, and that's what's fun and also frustrating about the Cup Series. You miss it a little bit, you start 26. So we got a lot of work to do. I think if we get the car where it needs to be, we can drive up through the field. Last year we started 20th and had a shot to win the race. It's just got to make no mistakes and do everything we can. If we're meant to go out there and score the points and have a chance at the playoffs, we'll do that. And if not, it's just about keeping getting better.
All right, Marty, we'll see if this team can march their way through the field from that 26th starting position.
Well, Kim, on the opposite end of that is Daniel Suarez. He will start first. Great time for that. I want to know, are you feeling any pressure being below the cut line with three to go?
No. I think that, you know, every single time that there is a pressure situation, a challenge situation, I see that as an opportunity. And I feel like today we have a huge opportunity ahead of us. And the car is very quick. My team has delivered. Right now, we already know we have a fast one. We just have to execute. I have to do my part. The picker has to do their part. And the most important thing, like I said yesterday, have fun.
Marty, below the cut line for Suarez equals opportunity.
So, Junior, it's an interesting stretch of the regular season here. Back-to-back road courses. Give me a driver that benefits and one driver that hurts.
One of the benefits is the man we just talked to right there, Daniel Suarez. Mm-hmm. He gained 29 points at Michigan last week. He's right back in this. We weren't talking about him. We didn't know what to think about Daniel. Now he's back in it, and we're going to another road course next week. The person that I'm a little concerned about, well, maybe not really. He's been piling up points a lot.
Yes.
It's Bubba Wallace. He was piling up points because he's not all that great at the road courses. Did finish fifth here last year, but he was piling those points up just so he could get through these road courses and then breeze through the ovals.
Yeah, the guy that I think and driver that we've heard speak very confidently of his abilities on the road course and at Daytona is Michael McDowell. He is right there where he can really take advantage of this situation the next 2 weeks, and we know he's a Daytona 500 champion and runs well at Daytona. The one that I'm concerned about is AJ Allmendinger.
What?
This is supposed to be his playground.
I know.
Right here. He's struggling. and has struggled. And I wonder if they can get it fixed either today or next week at Watkins Glen. And then are they just going to have to rely on a Hail Mary at Daytona like a lot of others?
That's an interesting observation, DJ. What about Chase Elliott? His last 22 road course starts, DJ. Seems pretty easy to divide them in half, doesn't it?
Yeah, you can see here. In those first 11 that he had, 7 wins. I mean, that's just incredible there of these that we're talking about. But with the next-gen car, he's had 8 chances, 0 wins. I think that the next-gen car took away some of his braking advantage that he had there. But now don't get totally discouraged about this. In those 8 races with the next-gen car, he has 5 top 5 and has led a lot of laps and could lead more here today.
And I don't think that they've actually shown the potential till this weekend, this year, right? So yeah. He's not really ran well since he's come back from injury. But he showed up this weekend, a lot of speed, qualified well. Hey. And we're going to Watkins Glen next week. Uh-huh. If they're not confident this weekend, next weekend's the race.
When we come back, who views Indy as their shot to get a win? DJ and Junior will tell us next as we get closer to the green flag. Countdown to Green is brought to you by Sonic, $2.99 Buffalo Chicken Dip Bites for a limited time only at Sonic. For over 100 years, the tradition of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway is unmatched this weekend. The most famous racetrack in the world plays host to an IndyCar NASCAR triple header from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. And it doesn't get any more iconic than that. Roger Penske and Jack Roush hanging out here on the grid. DJ, who looks at today as an opportunity for their team?
You know, there's young man Ty Gibbs, last year's Xfinity champion, made his way in that 16th spot last week after the Michigan race, won the Xfinity race here yesterday, has a lot of confidence going, but 3 very difficult races. How does he handle this pressure?
My pick is Tyler Reddick. I mean, the guy had a win in the palm of his hand last week at Michigan, an issue on pit road, loses the race for the team. They show up here, a race he won last year, and they're fast. He's my pick to win today.
They just have to clean up pit road, no doubt about it. The 45 team, Tyler Reddick, trying for back-to-back Indianapolis wins. When we come back, time for today's pre-race ceremonies. Green flag coming up for the NASCAR Cup Series at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. A packed grid for the Indianapolis Motor Speedway and a critical race for the NASCAR Cup Series with just 3 races left before the playoff field is locked in. DJ, put yourself in the driver's shoes. Who feels more pressure today, the bubble drivers or the international drivers with an entire country watching them and one race to get a win?
Yes. Yeah, all of them. Yeah, but you know, you mentioned the international drivers. That is their opportunity. It might be their one time to showcase their talents and what they can do. But the regulars that are battling to get into the playoffs, they do this week in and week out. I think the most pressure's there.
This road course is known for chaos, DJ. Do you see that calming down at all today?
Very little. You know, with the restart zone moved, it might be not be quite as chaotic, but there's still going to be plenty of chaos here today.
All right, time for today's pre-race ceremonies from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we ask that you please rise and remove your hats as service members from the Indiana National Guard present our nation's colors. Please welcome Pastor John McNary, lead pastor from Heartland Church, Sun Prairie, for today's invocation.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this incredible day. What a blessing it is to be in this place at this time for something as awesome as this event. Lord, we pray for those around the world who are hurting today, and we pray specifically for those who have been impacted by the fires in Maui. And Lord, we pray for your protection here today. Protect the drivers, the pit crews, and fans. Let today be a day that is marked by your good and perfect will. It's in Jesus' name that I pray, and everyone who agreed said, amen.
Here to perform our national anthem, please welcome Staff Sergeant Jenna Burke from the Indiana Army National Guard.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight blast gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the red so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, see does that star-spangled banner yet wave? O'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
On the other side, Jeff and Junior will bring us some of the storylines from the grid, plus Rick Allen and Steve Letarte as we get the engines cranked here at the world's greatest race course.
Been running fast, crossing county lines just to make my name in the city. Work for this for all these years and I wouldn't break or back down. No. I fought through all my fears and all of my frustrations. See the light is getting clear. I know I'm taking it down. It's my time.
Time will it be on the biggest stage in racing? It's NASCAR Cup Series from Indianapolis, Verizon 200 at the Brickyard. Three races remain in the regular season, and that means only three more opportunities for drivers to lock themselves into the playoffs. Guys that have won, they're in yellow. So those guys, they feel comfortable right now. But everyone around 16th and Ty Gibbs fighting for every point, every position on the racetrack to see if they can make it into the playoffs in 2023. Alongside our crew chief, Steve Letarte, Rick Allen with you. And Steve, when we talk about the bubble battle, it is really intense. The pressure has gotten to an all-time high here.
Well, the pressure is real, and we're going to focus on two drivers. I want to talk about first the guys above, specifically Bubba Wallace. Had a great Michigan, a great Richmond, extended that lead. Now sits 58 above the cut line. Does not love road course racing. It's going to be about attitude for Bubba Wallace because he needs to go out and just have an okay day. His concern, the chasers. Specifically, Daniel Suarez sits on the pole. There are points available in just 15 laps at the end of stage one. I think Bubba has to feel the pressure of drivers like Suarez.
You use the word chasers, but I want to say that Chase Elliott has to be a guy. Is he one of your favorites to win this race?
We've talked a lot about Chase and his resume and his seven wins. Throw it all out the window. I don't care. You know what I care? I care that nine car that Chase Elliott sits in today is fast. He's qualified third. He looked great in race trim. I think he's a real contender, but his battle is going to be real. When I look at all the manufacturers, Chase from Chevrolet, probably the favorite. Christopher Bell in that 20th Toyota. He was very good at Chicago Fast once again. And how can we miss Chris Buescher? Back-to-back wins. The guy's great at road courses. Eight top tens in a row. Could he go three in a row?
Yeah, he's the only one in the field that has that possibility of having three wins in a row in 2023. So we will find that out in just a few moments. But right now, it's time to fire the engines here in Indy.
Race fans, as part of Verizon's Small Business Days, Verizon is proud to welcome Kyle Milbour, president of Ace Safe Lock and Key, to give the command for today's Verizon 200.
Drivers, start your engines!
Down here on the grid, and we are right next to the man who shocked the sport, SVG Shane Van Gisbergen is back, but he has brought some friends with him this weekend, all the way back here in the 11th starting spot. Brody Kostecki is here this weekend, the points leader in supercars from Australia. He has had speed, qualified well, but he wrecked his car qualifying. He'll go to a backup and to the back of the field. This guy is less than 10 laps in a cup car, and he has that kind of speed. What can he do today, Jeff Burton?
Yeah, Dale Jr., this field is stacked. Check out what's behind me. F1 champion. We got the winner last year, A.J. Allmendinger. Denny Hamlin, 50-time race winner. These two young guys right here, they ran top four in this race. Look at this, Brad Keselowski, a champion. Ross Chastain, he's back here also. This field is absolutely stacked. If you're going to win it, you better step up your game today and make some stuff happen. When we come back, we're going to drop the green flag.
NBC Sports coverage of NASCAR is brought to you by Verizon, the network America relies on. Sonic. Sonic. And by Credit One Bank, a credit card company.
Turn one at Indy is just a crazy corner.
It's a wide straightaway and then a really sharp, narrow turn.
Get 22, come in like a bowling ball.
Guys just want to be 5 and 6 wide getting into that corner.
Ryan Blaney sideways in front of the field.
You're looking in your mirror trying to be prepared for a bump or a stack up. If you don't do it to the guy in front of you, the guy behind you is going to do it.
Oh, he's going to spin Denny. Denny has spun out.
It's one of those places that they could have a foot race and I'd want to win it.
It's hard to put into words.
It's one f***ing Indy. Yeah! Let's go kiss those bricks.
It is Indy, and want to check out the starting grid brought to you by Verizon. Up front, Daniel Suarez hasn't won this year. He's only 5 points out of the playoffs, but he's on pole, and he's right next to the guy who won the race a year ago, Tyler Reddick.
Well, it's a star pack starting 10. When you look, Christopher Bell back in row 4 next to SVG. Alex Bowman, a lot's made of Chase Elliott needing to win. Alex Bowman looking for that win in the playoffs as well.
Yeah, Brody Kostecki back here in the 11th position. He's going to have to go to the back because of a accident that he had in qualifying, but we look to see him move toward the front. He's going to be one of very many drivers that we know will be in the back moving to the front.
Yeah, row 12, two youngsters, Todd Gilliland, Harrison Burton, both great runs here a year ago, trying to replicate. How about row 13, Denny Hamlin, A.J. Allmendinger, the pressure is on early.
Yeah, right behind him, Kamui Kobayashi from Japan, the world-renowned driver, 75 F1 starts. How about back here, Steve?
Yeah, William Byron, you see, was not able to qualify because of some inspection issues. He'll actually have to make a pass-through under green as well, so not the weekend that William Byron has wanted to start. Hopefully he can fix it here during the race.
Cars working their way around this road course, and before they get the green flag, let's get a few updates from pit road. We'll start with Kim and Mark Truex Jr., a 5-time road course winner.
That's right, Rick, including this year at Sonoma, but in his 2 starts at the Indy, road course has not finished better than 15. So what's the team's outlook for this afternoon? They have every reason to believe they can win this race. Crew chief James Small said it does not matter what type of track this year, week in and week out, they feel like they've brought one of the best, if not the best race car. The rest of it, he said, is in Martin's hands. Martin was happy with the car in practice, and a happy Martin, Dave, is a very fast Martin Truex Jr.
Kim, the good news for William Byron is he has 4 wins on the 23 season. He is safely locked into the playoffs. The bad news, Steve just made reference to, with a technical issue in technical inspection, they failed 3 times, and part of that penalty is they didn't get to qualify, start in the back, and they'll be the first ones on pit road, not because they want to, but because they have to do that pass-through penalty once the green flag flies. Marty, they'll be hoping for an early caution to catch the field.
Well, Dave, when it comes to the Cup regulars and speed on the road courses, Tyler Reddick by far has been the best. The problem has been right here on pit road. A good example was last week at Michigan. They had the race in hand. They had a problem on a pit stop. Reddick told me that at the road courses and pretty much everywhere, I've not questioned our speed at all this year. The biggest question for me, can we execute on pit road? We have what I feel is the best car in the field. We have to take advantage of that today, and we need to clean things up in these final 3 regular season races before the playoffs.
Thanks, Marty. All right, Steve, let's dial up Shane Van Gisbergen, and he was the winner at Chicago. Let's see what his confidence level is coming in here to Indy.
All right, let's see if we can get him on the radio. Hey, Shane, it's everyone up in the NBC booth. You got a copy?
Yeah, I got you.
Well, Shane, welcome back to NASCAR. You're defending your perfect record, 1-for-1 at Chicago. Talk about the past 7 weeks. What's it been like since getting that big win?
It's just been a whirlwind, awesome experience, and so happy Project 91 track out to have me back. And we got enhanced health back on our Chevy this weekend and ready to go and have some fun. And starting up near the front here, and it's pretty cool, awesome experience.
Well, you have an amazing racing resume, not only in wins but where you've raced. But did you ever imagine you would take a green flag here at the historic Indianapolis Motor Speedway?
Stuff you always dream of, don't you? So I've got an awesome group of people around me, and even back home in Australia and New Zealand, good morning to them. But yeah, just to experience this with all these cool people around me and such an awesome team, I'm living the dream right now.
Well, we'll let you get back at it. We'll be cheering you along, just like everyone over in Australia. So good luck today.
Thanks, guys. Enjoy.
It's great to catch up with SVG. We talked about Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Let's look specifically at this road course. We'll ride along. So this is going down the front stretch. Drivers into turn one, about 170 miles an hour, a heavy braking zone, one of the first good passing opportunities.
Yeah, it really is. Tons of speed heading into turn one. You really want to get in here. See, SVG almost missed the corner there a little bit. Now it gets very tight, very complex part of corners. And then as you enter turn four, now you're thinking back straight away. Look what greets you. Turn five and turn six are very, very narrow complex, but you got to be wide open in the gas carrying speed to this back straightaway, because there's a great passing opportunity at the end.
Yeah, if you can get through that series of corners, you might have an opportunity in the braking zone down here in turn seven. But it's a hard 90 degree left into another series of switchbacks, turn eight and nine. Those have to be done well, or you set yourself up for a passing opportunity or to be passed down here in turn 10. A lot of contact, a lot of getting all over this curb right here back to the right. Then we lead on to a bend, sort of semi-full throttle through here. One of the toughest braking zones. The car's lifting up, the right front tire coming off the ground, and you're braking right here. You're locking up the right front, maybe locking up the rears and missing this corner entirely.
Yeah, then you got 13. Very, very tight. Watch how tight this left-hander is, but you better hit it right, because being on the throttle right here is huge. If you don't get that right, now you do not have momentum down this long front straightaway and that passing opportunity in turn one. A very fast racetrack, but you have to be precise.
And they're going to do it 82 times in the completion of this race. Now they're coming onto pit road to check their pit road speed. Let's also go down to pit road, and we'll check back in with Kim. And let's talk a little bit about the four-time road course winner, Kyle Busch.
That's right, Rick. When it comes to who's going to be strong today, you cannot ignore Kyle Busch and this number eight RCR team. Kyle has four straight tight fives on the last four road courses this season, and his crew chief, Randall Burnett, he won this race last year. I asked Randall what it takes to win here. He said, a fast car, a really great driver, and making sure you make no mistakes. Dave, they roll off from the fifth position.
You'll see Denny Hamlin coming from the back today. He qualified 25th. I talked to crew chief Chris Gabehart about that. He did not seem too concerned. We were just slow, he said. It's a process Denny's working on in qualifying. Not quite there yet. He did some homework overnight, he said. Expects to go forward, Marty.
Well, Dave, thanks to Chris Buescher. For the first time in 13 years, Roush Fenway Keselowski Racing has now won back-to-back races with a win at Richmond and then following up with a win at Michigan. I asked the team how Buescher is here today. They said, just okay, but Buescher is known for this type of run, not flashing a lot of speed in practice. But Rick, don't be surprised if he's in the mix for at least a top 10 today. He's finished top 10 in nine of the last 10 road course races.
Yeah, Marty, he's impressed us all for so long, and now we're seeing the fruits of his labor as he's got two wins coming into this, looking for his third. Verizon Frontline is the advanced network for first responders. Today, Verizon is honoring the members of the Indianapolis Metropolitan Police Department, Indiana State Police, Marion County Sheriff's Office, Speedway Fire Department and Police Department, and the Indianapolis EMS and Fire Department. Please join Verizon in thanking first responders for all they do for us every day. All right, Steve, I mentioned 82 laps. Break this race down for us.
Yeah, 82 laps at a 14-corner road course. We're going to have stages. Stage 1, 15 laps. Stage 2, 20. Final stage, very long at 47 laps. Fuel window, 30 to 32 laps. But very important, guys, no yellow. The stage will end. Points will be awarded. We'll keep racing under green.
You know, one thing that's new this year is a
modified restart zone. They relocated the restart zone because there was so much chaos into turn one, the drivers really couldn't avoid it. So they moved it here, Junior, to kind of spread the field apart, but there's still going to be chaos into turn one.
Yeah, we saw how it worked yesterday in the Xfinity race and at other tracks where they've done this. It's been successful. We've seen way too many bad, nasty pileups late in the race down in turn one, taking drivers out of contention. Probably going to see some contact and drama still today, but nothing like we've seen before.
And I want to mention the uniqueness. They're able to change lanes and start racing the second they leave that restart zone. So if you do see somebody before they get to the start finish line changing lanes and racing right away, that happens because that's the new rule here at Indy.
That's right. Let's see it happen right now.
Here they come into the start zone from Indy. We're racing on the road course. Suarez jumps out to a good start. Three car lengths entering turn number one. Tyler Reddick in second, but a great battle for third as they enter turn one.
And we're still going to see the aggressive dive bombs. Look at that's contact. SVG down on the inside there, trying to make passes early.
Further back, I think Todd Gilliland got into Brad Keselowski. Both of them got through there, but lost some positions.
McDowell almost wide right there through four. Now side by side through five and six. This doesn't work. Chase Elliott thinks better of it. Gives up momentum to the five car. Larson now to the inside. Now Larson will be on the outside of turn seven. Battling for fourth back there. Reddick putting the pressure on for the lead.
Saw Christopher Bell working to the outside. Fighting for position. Larson and Ben Gisbergen right around them.
That was a lot of contact for SVG and several other cars down in turn one. You hate to see that on the very first lap. We talked about the chaos on turn one. The restart zone is going to help, but not take it all away, right? And the intensity is going to continue to pick up in the third stage. Here we go. Christopher Bell right there. See, SVG has to correct the car back into the 20. That really makes him the meat of the sandwich.
And to be clear, you're racing against Cup regulars on their ballpark, and I'm telling you, if you run into those guys, they're not going to put up with it very long at all. Patience will be low.
And you see at the very, very top of the screen, William Byron coming to pit road, serving that penalty.
Steve, you touched on this. Dave?
So here comes William Byron as you see the field now pouring down into turn number one. Everybody looking pretty clean there, even with a couple of dive bombs. But as he serves his penalty, crew chief Rudy Fugel told me it's a good thing because we'll be in clean air after this. We can learn about our race car. It's obviously a bad thing because we're very far behind. As you see lots of action, they need a caution to catch back up to the field.
Yeah, Louis Kobayashi gets turned around in the 67. This is a third 23-11 and third 23-11 entry. Oh. Justin Haley, big off. Driver's left, that's out of five and six, gets to the driver's left. Heavy contact for Haley.
Man, I can't wait to see how this happened. That was a high speed crash right there. He's gonna be able to drive the car away. The tire barrier doing a lot of good work there.
Big contact with the tire barrier. Let's look again what happened.
I was side by side. That's a very narrow part of the racetrack through five and six. Logano jumps the curbs and ends up getting contact with Haley. Pushes Haley out of in the grass, and now Haley's just along for the ride. Watch as he hits these tire barriers. Those things are great when you hit them head on, but when you hit them sideways, it just pulls them apart from each other.
We saw on the initial lap, Chase Elliott opting to not do that through that corner, not go side by side through there. Now we see the replay, the 67. Kobayashi gets a little contact there from the 51 car.
Andy Lally got into the 67 there. Let's ride along with Kamui.
Yeah, Kamui's gonna be pretty frustrated with that. You know, it's you expect them to come in and race with respect, but you should give them a little respect too. Probably not as much as he was hoping for right there.
First caution comes out early, and it's for that right there. We see Justin Haley and all the damage to the 31. Logano gets into him, sends him off track, and into the tire barrier on lap two at Indy. Japan's Kamui Kobayashi behind the wheel of the 67, making his first ever start in the Cup Series in NASCAR, a dream of his to be able to do this from a very young boy back in Japan, had dreams of being in NASCAR.
Yeah, when we talked to him this week, super excited, said he was real worried about the small details. He hopes he doesn't mess those up. That's going to be fun to watch as he learns over the course of the race.
So Kamui Kobayashi makes his first career NASCAR Cup Series start here in Indianapolis. To prepare for this weekend, Kobayashi tested the number 67 Toyota Genuine Parts Camry TRD at VIR, Virginia International Raceway, back in July, and has also participated in multiple simulator sessions at TRD in Salisbury, North Carolina. The Toyota driver, Tyler Reddick, was present at the VIR test and has been a huge asset to Kamui. And today he is living out his dream, competing in a NASCAR Cup Series race. Kamui Kobayashi, to the attention of his crew, we'll be back for the restart. NBC Sports coverage of NASCAR is brought to you by Sunoco, fueling victories for 20 years as the official fuel of NASCAR, and by Verizon, the network America relies on. See all smiles for Scott Dixon. It's a combo weekend here at Indianapolis Motor Speedway and the road course. He was able to get back to victory lane yesterday, and so impressive to see him now a six-time champion and continuing to win, dominate races, look so good.
Yeah, he's eternal. It's incredible. Got an opportunity to be put through strategy out in the lead and was able to hang on to it. Just at his age, to be as good and as fast as he is simply impressive, and we're watching, you know, generational talent. So in the twilight of his career, how many more can he win?
Yeah, he's won in 19 straight years, and the heartbreak of motorsports, Graham Rahal finished second, had an extremely fast car, just kind of ran out of time. Felt bad for him, but what a great race.
An Australian driver giving a little international feel to IndyCar. Well, also a very international feel here in NASCAR. Seven different countries are represented today with Shane Van Gisbergen of New Zealand. You got Mike Rockenfeller out of Germany, then Brody Konecny of Australia. Throw in Daniel Suarez, a regular here in the Cup Series, from Mexico. Kamui Kobayashi of Japan. Jenson Button from England. And then 33 drivers making out the field, all from right here in the United States. So a very international field. And when you say international field, a lot of times you'll say, well, he's from this country, this country. Those drivers are dominant in their countries and are famous from their country. So a very international flavor to this field today. If you ride along with the freeway.com on board of Daniel Suarez looking back, he will once again be on the inside, and Reddick will restart on his outside. There's the enhanced health, number 91 of Shane Van Gisbergen. Well, we saw one start from this restart area. We're about to see another restart. Steve, what are we expecting?
Well, I think you're going to, Dale mentioned, we're going to see racing right away. While it calms things down at turn one, it does anything but right here leaving the zone.
One, green flag.
2x2, not as big a jump that time for Daniel Suarez, as Reddick's able to stay right behind him. Now he changes lanes. He's got Chase Elliott right there on the inside.
This is the second restart for these drivers. Look out, more intense. Oh, contact the 22 into the back of his teammate, Ryan Blaney.
Logano turns around, and we'll see if everybody's able to get around him. He keeps it going, and we stay green.
You can see how more intense that restart was than the very first.
And here they come in that really tight complex. Are they going to get single file? Yes, Kyle Larson did not make the mistake that the Tyus did before and run through here side by side.
It's been quite a day for the 22 of Joey Logano, involved in the Justin Haley incident, and now has an issue into turn one.
You have to wonder if the damage or the contact to the left front in that wreck with Justin Haley affected the ability to break into turn one.
See the 34 of Michael McDowell now pressuring Suarez, running in that second spot, and out wide is the 5 of Kyle Larson.
8 was underneath him wrecking. Kyle Busch gathers it up. Christopher Bell now peeking to the right. This is action, man.
The 34 trying to outbreak Suarez for the lead.
Suarez got a battle on this inside now. Coming into this turn. Turn 12, Now into turn 13. McDowell's on the inside, has a preferred line, and takes the spot away.
At 14, a new leader at Indy, Michael McDowell out front.
Yeah, good pace in practice.
Suarez has good momentum behind him, though. Can he try to repass him into turn one?
Just the replay from turn one. Logano's coming from way back. That car had no chance, and I don't think it was performing in the braking zone like he expected. Locked up the rear tires there. Truex to the inside here of the 12 car.
Yeah, a little contact looked like there between Blaney and Truex through one.
I think it's impossible to go through turn one side to side without making contact, it seems. Blaney's going to get that spot up. But I was talking about McDowell. He had practice speed. No surprise to see this car run well, but also drive up and take the lead. Front Row Motorsports leading outright. Incredible. Kim.
And Dale, when I talked with Michael this morning, he was absolutely fired up, very confident, said we have speed in the car, especially on the long run. And he said you only get so many opportunities at wins and even top fives in the series because the field is so deep. We cannot waste that opportunity today. Expect us to be very aggressive attacking the track and very aggressive on pit road and with strategy.
Yeah, and one of Michael's concerns is pit road. You know, can this young, this little team take on these giants and have the pit stops that they need? Execution in every area of the race is what Michael told me he was concerned about.
And it was announced earlier this week that Front Row Motorsports was going to make sure their drivers stayed in place through next year, so their contract's extended, and that includes Todd Gilliland.
Well, with one bubble driver leading, trouble for another bubble driver, Ty Gibbs just above the bubble. Watch this chaos. Smoke, we saw the 22, but keep watching. Right-hand side of your screen, there it is. The black number 54 kind of gets spit out right here, riding on board with SVG, a little contact. And then right across the bumper, SVG aggressive early.
And in supercars, they told us, Brody and SVG both said, the bumping on bumpers front to back is not allowed in supercars, but you can hit a guy on the side. So that would not have gone over well in supercars.
I don't think it's going to go over too well in NASCAR. Ty Gibbs is going to have to be pretty frustrated to be this early in the race, I think.
Well, there was heavy contact with him and Christopher Bell, so I'd be concerned about that. Also, Christopher Bell's car has been ran into by multiple cars already in his first few laps.
Here's Ty Gibbs working to the inside of Kevin Harvick in that four.
You see how far behind the 54 is after that spin, and I think that's what pushed Joey Logano so hard this race. You got to get track position. I mean, the start of the race and restarts are an opportunity to do it. Did not work out for Joey Logano, and he's actually behind this group of cars.
Also, right in the mix here, we saw the 33 of Brody Konecny. And Brody, having to start at the back with a backup car, had a pretty good qualifying run.
But now the backup car's got about as much experience as he does.
That's right. Dave.
So, Rick, you got to understand, Brody Konecny, even though he's a superstar in supercars, he didn't even get a test like a lot of the drivers who don't run in this series did before he raced here. His first laps were at speed in practice, and he only got a couple of those because they had a mechanical issue. So Brody's learning on the fly. Right now, he's about to get dive-bombed down into turn one.
And it's Kamui Kobayashi who goes by, but he goes a little bit too deep into turn number one, and he'll lose a couple spots.
Luckily, unlike Chicago, there's room to run off. There's room to make mistakes. I think that's why we're seeing more mistakes from all these new drivers in NASCAR. You just trying to get too much out of the car, but understanding now that the car doesn't have that kind of performance down into turn one.
Fortunately, there was a place for him to go. Look at the gap in between cars right here. If not, that would have been a big wreck. So Kobayashi needs to recognize there's some learning to do. Let's back the pace down a little bit. It's a long race. Learn this car a little bit and then go on attack.
See the Coke Zero Sugar on board of Joey Logano. Again, Logano has been involved in two incidents already in this young race.
Tough camera. I'm not sure that one was still going to be there after they contacted turn one.
Mentioned the long race. Again, 7 laps still to go before the end of stage 1. And a reminder, there will not be a caution at the end of the stage. They will continue to run.
But there will be points awarded to that top 10. So when you look at McDowell, Suarez, Chase Elliott, all these drivers, Alex Bowman, drivers that are looking to make the playoffs, those points, very important.
Here's Bowman dropping a spot to Van Gisbergen. Little bumping there from Bowman.
Inside.
Bowman trying to take the spot right back from Shane. They stay side by side, and then down that long back stretch into turn 7. We'll see how aggressive SVG gets with Bowman.
He's under attack. Car not really having the pace that he was hoping for right now.
Chase Briscoe on the 14 gets by SVG. It's been an eventful 9 laps already for Joey Logano. Turn 1, big hit into the back of Ryan Blaney. Hey, race fans, when in Las Vegas, stay where the racers stay at the South Point Hotel, Casino, and Spa. Your ultimate pit stop on the Las Vegas Strip. South Point, everything you want, all under one roof. You're watching the NASCAR Cup Series Verizon 200 at the Brickyard. Take a look at a little contact being made between a couple drivers, including Andy Lally and Ty Gibbs.
Yeah, Andy Lally and Ty Gibbs are going at it. And this went on for quite a while. Ty giving it to the 51 just a little bit. Then this is down the front straightaway. More contact. Andy Lally says, no, I don't like it. Now Ty Gibbs got to try to pass him all over again. Finally does it. That's going on, though, all through the field. Maybe not to that extent, but been pretty crazy.
Ty dominated the Xfinity race yesterday and won it. See Kevin Harvick hitting pit road. Kim.
And crew chief Rodney Childers told me their only option today, because of how bad they qualified, was to do something completely different strategy-wise. And for them, that is being one of the first ones to make a stop under green. He said he has good drive off, still needs a little bit more turn. That was the same issue they had throughout practice. 4 tires, Sunoco fuel with a slight air pressure adjustment on those Goodyears.
Strategy at road course racing is a little different than ovals, because you could pit like Kevin Harvick is here with no fear of losing a lap. So the concept is come in, fill up, and put tires on. In case a yellow comes out, if everybody else has to come to pit road, you can leapfrog them. So you kind of run the race backwards. This is aggressive, for sure, a little outside their fuel window. But I agree with what crew chief Rodney Childers said. Hey, when you have no track position, you have to do something different. Now McDowell on board with Suarez chasing McDowell. I expect these two to at least run to that magical lap 15, which would be the end of stage 1.
Yes, Steve, I think that first caution, or the first 2 cautions, I should say, bought everybody a little bit more time, so they may extend that first window. But yes, the window open right now, and it should just be a 2-stop race for all the cars and crew chiefs and pit crews as well, Steve. So how has no cautions at the end of the stages really changed the game on road courses?
Well, when you know there's a caution, it's really just a decision whether you take track position or the points. Now, not knowing where the cautions are, you have to really kind of call it a little old school. You want to pit nice and early in case a yellow comes out, but if you pit too early, you either put yourself in a fuel situation or you have old tires on and you slip and slide for the cars on fresher tires.
And want to take a look at the Xfinity fastest lap. It's Daniel Suarez, who had won the pole on lap 10. He turned the fastest lap of anyone, and Suarez right now running in the 2nd spot. But an average of over 98 miles per hour around this 14-turn, just under 2.5-mile road course.
Saw William Byron to serve a penalty at the start of the race in the back of the pack, trying to work himself up through. And you can see that very narrow part of the racetrack. And 5 and 6, contact with the 78 car of Josh Balicki. A lot of aggression early in this race.
It does seem like there is a lot of intensity early in this race as well. We see McDowell still about 3-4 car lengths in front of Suarez. Dave.
Shane Van Gisbergen in 10th place now. He does not have a perfect race car. Listen to these 2 radio transmissions.
Throttle pedal's a little bit sticky at the moment too. On throttle crack, it's quite hard to push, and then it cracks forward to 10th descent, so hopefully that doesn't hurt the tires too much.
If it starts getting worse, make sure you let us know.
I'm struggling with the rear, got no rear, and the throttle pedal's making the initial drive very hard.
Getting the initial drive very hard. Sticky throttle pedal. Drivers, how bad is that on a road course?
Well, you just can't. Other cars coming down pit road. You see Ryan Blaney, who's really said nothing of the contact with his teammate Joey Logano on the track. Here's the benefit of doing this, Steve. There's one lap to go in the stage. As you can see on the left-hand side of your screen, you're going to pit first, get those tires on before everybody else. The bad side of that, though, you're going to give up all these stage points that McDowell, Suarez, Elliott, all those guys will get. But Jonathan Hassler making the call to bring Ryan Blaney down pit road.
It's a different, you know, we talk about agendas. You know, Ryan Blaney, he's won a race. So he knows he's moving forward in the playoffs. He's concerned about trying to win this race. We see Joey Logano joining his Penske teammate of Ryan Blaney on pit road. The battle up top for this race or stage win. Suarez is continuing to put the pressure on McDowell, not letting this be an easy cruise.
And staying within a couple seconds is Chase Elliott, the man who absolutely needs a win to make the playoffs. He's making a good run for it this early in the race. Good speed in the nine car.
Monumental start for Front Row Motorsports. This will be the first ever stage win for Front Row Motorsports, as well as the first stage win for Michael McDowell. So a big stage win there. And again, there won't be a caution, but he will get the 10 points for winning the stage and a playoff point.
Yeah, big for that team where they are battling among the bubble as well for the 99 car. Critical points early in stage one.
And this is new this year, no yellow. We continue to talk about it because it does change kind of the outlook of the race. And actually also puts more value on qualifying, right? What you're seeing right here from McDowell and Suarez and Elliott, all these cars that had track position to start the race holding on to it.
To wrap up what Dave was talking about with Shane Van Gisbergen, the throttle is hard to mash. And when he does mash it, it ends up going too far. When he has, it's hard to push, but when it does engage, he's getting more, you know, say if he wants to mash it 20% and just kind of barely get into the throttle, it's going to 40 or going to 50 and spinning and hurting the rear tires. So that's going to be tough to fix. I don't think they can fix it. So he'll have to deal with that all day long, Marty.
Couple cars on pit road. Chris Buescher back-to-back wins and struggling so far today. As predicted, car a little bit too free for Buescher. No stage points there in stage one, but a pretty significant adjustment trying to tighten up the car for Chris Buescher. And I think pit road is about to get very busy, guys.
As we see the leaders stay on the racetrack, Chase chases them as well, but it's a split. Reddick comes to pit road as well. So the concern with staying on the racetrack is if a yellow comes out, anyone who has pitted is not going to pit again. So if you have to pit under the yellow, then you instantly give up your track position. And it's normally we see everybody kind of pit in a one or two lap window. This is very interesting, right? This now basically been a five or six lap window of cars trickling two or three time, cars at a time onto pit road.
Reddick slow on pit road all the way down to his pit stall. Allmendinger as well. Stuckey and Byron all on pit road. Marty.
Yeah, this is interesting with these wide windows, Steve. It's going to be interesting to see where all these guys blend back out. A.J. Allmendinger saying lateral grip is okay in his car. He's on the bottom of the screen. He needs more front turn. Kind of the opposite for Tyler Reddick, saying the car just way too free. Billy Scott told his crew after their rough pit stop at the end of the race at Michigan, hey, just slow down this weekend. We have a good car. Let's just have simple stops, Dave.
Here's something Brody Kostecki has never done. Live pit stops in NASCAR. He hit his marks perfectly. He'll get four Goodyear tires at Sunoco Fuel. Also, William Byron in the 24 is on pit road. He'll be leaving again with a full tank of Sunoco Fuel.
And McDowell still has to come to pit road. You're watching the NASCAR Cup Series, Verizon 200 at the Brickyard.
I watched my first race yesterday.
You're on the team, kid. It's orientation day.
Hey, new guy, let's get you up to speed.
Lunchtime! Your workspace is ready.
Looks like you got a corner office.
Be part of something greater. Toyota. Let's go places.
Ashley's Labor Day mattress sale is going on now. Get 0% interest for 60 months on in-store mattress purchases. Save up to $700 on select Tempur-Pedic adjustable base sets or up to $900 on select Purple and Beautyrest Black adjustable base sets. Only at Ashley.
Let Innovation Refunds help with your ERC tax refund so you can improve your business however you see fit. Rosie used part of her refund to build an outdoor patio.
Clink.
Dr. Marshall used part of his refund to give his practice a facelift. Emily used part of her refund to buy.
I run a wax museum.
Let Innovation Refunds help you get started on your ERC tax refund. Stop waiting. Go to innovationrefunds.com. You really got the brows.
With Wendy's BOGO Dollar Deal, your dollar never tasted so good. So everyone's going to get
spicy chicken tenders and nugs.
I was going to say a frosty and a frosty.
You can do that.
I don't know. Willie's really smart.
Choose wisely. Choose Wendy's buy one, get one for a buck.
Wow. You get to watch all your favorite stuff.
It's to die for, and it's all right here.
Streaming was never this easy, you know.
This is the way.
Really went all out, didn't you?
It's called commitment.
Can you turn on the volume?
Here, you can try.
Get way more into what you're into when you stream on the Xfinity 10G network.
There's a thin line in the NASCAR Xfinity Series between winning and losing, between being the future and being past, between headlines and tailspins, between making history and being it. Between the sweet taste of victory and the fumes of defeat. In the NASCAR Xfinity Series, there's a thin line between being a name they know and being a name they'll never forget.
It's your last chance to punch your tickets to Vegas. What a battle!
I'm going for the $1 million. Vegas, here I come.
Vance Walker, what power!
Oh, it's gonna be close!
American Ninja Warrior, Monday on NBC.
NASCAR Fantasy Live lets you keep tabs on your fantasy lineup throughout the race. You can adjust your picks until the end of Stage 2 to maximize your score. Visit NASCAR.com/fantasy, where you can select the fantasy icon on the mobile app leaderboard to make in-race changes. So a lot of drivers making the way onto pit road, cycling through, and there's a lot of road to be gained when you come onto pit road.
Well, right here, you see Suarez and McDowell. They're flipped. McDowell was leading, and now battle between the 9 and the 5. The 9 ran a couple laps longer, and I think ended up costing a little time to Larson. This wasn't really that close before the green flag cycle.
I was interested to see that 5 car trying that pass in the braking zone on the outside. If he could position himself on the right side of the 9 for the next few corners, he might have been able to take the spot away. But right now, looks like the 5 of Larson just a little bit quicker than Chase.
So if you go back to who we think is going to be the leader of the race through the cycle, it was McDowell at the beginning. We'll come into pit road. Pit road speed, there's an access road, but pit road speed does not start until the yellow line. Look at how conservative the 34 slows down. Bravo, Daniel Suarez. Look how much is gained.
That's a great opportunity right here, and Daniel takes every bit of it. You can see his car was out of control. And then look what happens at the end of pit road. That little bit of gain by Suarez and a little bit quicker stop, and they take the lead away from McDowell.
When pit stop cycle through, there are still 11 that are in front of those two that have not come to pit road under this most recent cycle of pit stops.
And that was, remember, that was what McDowell told me his concern was being able to run the race and executing everything perfectly. And that was not just on the pit crew. That was on him as well. There was more for him to get on pit road. Suarez did better and lost the spot.
Yeah, and a couple guys getting speeding penalties, and two of them kind of famous in the fact that Jensen Button, he normally pushes a button when he comes onto pit road, so he doesn't have to worry normally about speeding. They got a speeding penalty. So did Mike Rockenfeller in the 42, as well as the 7 of Corey LaJoy, all caught for speeding on pit road. Marty.
Rick, Chase Elliott has already pitted. You saw that a moment ago. And at the end of that run, Chase Elliott was the fastest car. So Alan Gustafson, Steve, made the call to leave him out one lap longer. Do you think that benefited the 9 to stay out there and run one more lap in clean traffic?
Looking at the racetrack, no. I think it cost the 9 time. I think the cars that came in and pitted earlier actually had a little bit more efficient stops, using the 5 as Larson as the example. The 9 had a little bit of space to Larson, and now Larson is only a few car lengths behind him.
Chase Elliott's about 2 seconds now behind McDowell, and they were a lot closer when pit stop cycle started.
The most important thing is he came from third. He's still third. A little bit of time on track. You expect there's going to be a yellow at some point. It's more, don't make a mistake. You listed those three drivers that were caught speeding, and that just puts you so far behind for the rest of the day.
Again, a reminder, right now, the top seven still have not come to pit road at all. Then 8th, 9th, and 10th, they came on lap 3 and lap 4 when the caution was out. They still have to come. And, Steve, how far can you go on a tank of fuel?
So we know they can go 30 to 32 pretty comfortably. We had a few pace laps, three of them. But I also think that the teams are holding that fuel mileage pretty close to the vest. I think they could probably run a little further than 32 if they have to. I think it's just a play of being most efficient on tires, so I expect the leaders to pit somewhere around probably lap 25 or 26.
McDowell getting a little bit bigger in the mirror for Suarez in this break of zone at turn 11. As these two start to worry each other, they start to slow down just a little bit. The last lap on the racetrack, the 9 of Chase Elliott about 3/10 quicker. He's going to start to creep into this battle, as will the 5, and then also the fastest car on the racetrack the last time by, Kyle Busch.
Kyle Busch right now running in the 15th position, but again, that's relative to the 10 drivers that still have yet to come to pit road. And these two, Suarez and McDowell, when they came in, they were just below that cut line of making it into the playoffs. And so there's the battle within the battle. Obviously, the potential for a race win locks you into the playoffs, but then every point matters in the big picture of getting into the playoffs.
Well, you can see how tight it is. Bubba Wallace, he stayed on the racetrack currently. He looks pretty good in the playoffs. Road courses have been a concern for him. McDowell, Suarez, we saw Gibbs had that trouble earlier. Allmendinger has not had the pace we normally see from him. But as we watch these two guys, the car that is getting closer to them is that 9 of Chase Elliott. He is actually faster than they are. He is starting to run them down.
See Martin Truex Jr. on pit road, so he will give up that third spot. Kim.
And he was happy with the car yesterday in practice. Not the case today. Told the team he has no turn or drive off. Very hard to get the gas down. They will put air pressure adjustments on those four fresh Goodyear tires as you see the crew to the left side. Remember, left side first. These choreographies here, a little bit backwards. Four tires, Sunoco Fuel, Marty, for Martin Truex Jr.
Kim, in our pre-race show, Dale Earnhardt Jr. talked about how Bubba Wallace and his crew chief, Booty Barker, have been stockpiling points over the last few weeks. In fact, in the last three races, they have earned the fifth most points. And Booty told me this morning, I'm going to do the opposite of what everybody else does today just to try something. And no, road courses are not Bubba Wallace's strength, so leaving him out a little bit longer, Wallace will pit this time by, though. But he reminded me, hey, we finished fifth in this race last year. You never know what can happen.
I love this idea because you leave him out in some clear track. You're talking about, when we talk about strategy for the win, that's one thing. That's what the 99 and the 34 is doing. And I'm not saying Bubba Wallace cannot win, but he would tell you that this is just not his forte. He is learning the road courses. It's not his best stuff. His mindset coming in, very important. He's gained a bunch of points, over 30 points in the last two ovals. You can't give them all back at the first road course. That's really what this 23 car is doing, running a little long, trying to take some of the pressure off versus, look at this pressure pack battle right here, right? Suarez and McDowell, they're thinking we could win. Chase Elliott right back there is thinking, I'm sick of top fives at the road courses. I want to get a win.
Yeah, the fastest of these three cars has been Chase Elliott, as now we see Shane Van Gisbergen on pit road once again, Dave.
The Chicago Street Race winner is coming down pit road. His car is pretty good right now, except for that sticky throttle pedal issue. So he'll go for four tires and fuel here and see if he can get back into the mix. They liked his lap times a lot, Marty, right near the end of his run.
So they asked Bubba Wallace how the car was as he comes down pit road, and he said, I just need a little more lateral grip. So they'll lose about 49 seconds here on pit road. So that should put Bubba about 15. So a solid day so far for the 23. Exactly what they hoped for. Exactly what they needed.
Well, fans, NASCAR and the premier partners want to thank you. Visit NASCAR.com/thankyoufans to learn how you can win an exclusive diamond experience just for being a fan. Building the next generation of U.S. Navy submarines means stable, sustaining jobs across the country. If you want to work with purpose, we're looking for you. Visit BuildSubmarines.com for career and training opportunities. Bell out in front of the field here. Austin Dillon running in second. Denny Hamlin is third. Those three have not been to pit lane yet, as well as Brad Keselowski, who was on pit lane on lap three, but he is currently running in the fourth position. Then Suarez and McDowell, we knew those two were going to cycle to the front. They have been battling for position. Once Suarez came off of pit road in front of McDowell. McDowell has not been able to get by him, but the gap is very close. A couple guys who have been watching from Victory Circle, and they're very familiar with that, is DJ and Hinch. And guys, were you expecting this aggression so early in this race?
Yeah, that's a great question, Rick. I think that Cup drivers always wonder, when they have drivers that they haven't competed with very much, how they're going to treat them. And Hitches, it's something that drivers, when they come, they watch what happens in this series, and drivers push each other around. Is that something they feel like they need to do?
Well, here's the thing. I think those drivers want to be respectful. They're on another guy's turf. They don't want to make a bad reputation. We've seen a lot of aggression from them, but I honestly think some of it is inadvertent aggression. They're still learning the limits of these race cars. We saw Kobayashi go long down a turn.
Next time we come to you guys, you're going to have to be indoors, because with the cars rocketing by you on the front stretch, you are so difficult to hear. But great stuff down there, guys. We appreciate it.
Battle right here picking up between these group. Chase Elliott lost the touch to these two a few laps ago trying to get around Ty Dillon. Now has closed the gap back up. The 99's missing some corners. You see it right there, a little bit wide.
McDowell trying to capitalize on it, and right back behind them is Chase Elliott, so hungry for a win in 2023. Marty.
Could today be the day for Chase Elliott? It might be. Chase Elliott has not won a road course race with this next-gen car, but they are so quick, especially at the end of runs. I talked to Alan Gustafson this morning. He said, listen, we focus on every race, but we have put a lot into Indianapolis and into Watkins Glen next week as well. They expect to be even better at Watkins Glen next week. So, Junior, do you think the road courses are Chase Elliott's best path to the playoff for the win?
Yeah, absolutely. He's showing great speed today. You see the five car of Kyle Larson. He missed turn 11 and had to go over and park in the runoff, so he did not get penalized. He rejoins the field, but we're seeing it. I know this is not the battle for the lead right here. It should be once the cycle goes through. The 9 car looks like the best car on the racetrack right now. This is Larson in the larger screen. He's going to miss. Oh, big lockup with the right front. Just not going to make the corner, so he goes over here. He's got to stop. Comes a complete stop. Good job. NASCAR's going to watch that and make sure you do that properly. He does it. And he blends back into traffic. That lockup, though, on the right front is concerning on the flat spot tire, how that's going to affect the handling, and can the tire make it the full run here. We continue to watch this battle. Rage on the 34, trying to put the pressure on. Suarez has been missing some apexes. His car just not quite handling and turning the way he wants. More pressure the 34 can put on. He might work him into a mistake. Chase Elliott watches behind for an opportunity to get around both drivers.
And Steve, with the strategy that we've already seen, guys that have come to pit road around lap 17, 18, 16, how far are they going to go? How far will they stretch it? And how far do they need to go to make it to the end?
Well, I think if they get to, you know, 32, 33 to go, they're going to feel very good about it, as we see Austin Dillon come to pit road now. You know, he's run 28 green flag laps plus the pace laps. So I expect Suarez and McDowell and those cars, they're really looking for, you know, 32, 33 laps to go in the race.
Again, firing down into turn one. Suarez just in front of Michael McDowell and then Chase Elliott. McDowell staying within about a car length of Suarez, but not able to put as much pressure on that 99 as he would like to. Chase Elliott, after breaking a bone in a ski boarding incident earlier in the year. He was out for 6 weeks, and then a penalty for rough driving put him out for another week. And so missing seven races out from behind the wheel of the car has put him into a hole. And so he is looking to get out of that hole potentially today if he could get to victory lane.
That miss by the five, we showed him miss the corner. It ended up costing, I believe, really just three spots. I think he lost a spot to Busch, to Reddick, and to Briscoe for cars that are on his strategy. He also lost a spot to Ty Dillon. Ty still has to come to pit road in that 77 on the left side of your screen. You see he's in the eighth position.
Good lap there. Really good back section.
Listening into the radio there, Suarez mentioned a good lap, also a great lap. Shane Van Gisbergen was the fastest car on the track just a lap ago.
Yeah, the cars that pitted later, while tires aren't a gigantic advantage, much like, you know, at Sonoma, they would be a bigger advantage. This track, relatively smooth. New tires are still better, and the fresher tires definitely are showing up. Good laps.
Steve, what strategy is Denny Hamlin playing? Denny Hamlin right now hasn't been to pit road.
So he has no track position, so he's just going to run as long as he can to keep the freshest tires on versus the field. If the caution comes out right now, he knows he has to pit, and 10 or 15 or 20 may stay out, but the back 10 cars are going to pit anyway. He's going to cycle out kind of mid-pack, which is where he was. Marty, he doesn't expect to drive all the way to the front.
Well, I would think he would hope he could drive to the front, but that would be awfully hard today. Track position is the key for everything. You guys mentioned Kyle Larson. He lost those spots back to 11th right now. Here's the thing, Junior. You mentioned how tough a flat spot is on the car. Larson said it is definitely splat-flatted on that right front. They told him to take it easy on the brakes, and he said it's worse in the left-handers for some reason. So why is a flat spot, Junior, so bad for the driver?
Well, it actually squares the tire, and so the next time you match the brake pedal in a braking zone, it wants to hang up on that flat spot and slide the tire again. It's really, you know, you will have a small vibration that might hurt the turn, the ability of the car to grip the front and roll through the center of the corner. But mainly the biggest problem is trying to brake deep into the corner. It'll hang up on that flat spot. There's a spin right there, the 16 car. AJ Allmendinger had a big spin. This is over in the NASCAR Oval number one. So this is, he must have had a big issue coming in to turn 11.
Yeah, he is way off the racetrack right there. You see the fire coming out of it. He's trying to get it fired back up. That's actually the exhaust pipe.
Actually, I think he spun out of the final corner here, turn 13. Yeah. Car just come out from under him. I don't know how that could happen.
There you go.
He's not been happy with this race car all weekend. We came here expecting him to be a contender for this win, but he just has not had speed. Here it is.
Contact.
12, he just crashed.
So, Jeff, that was him jumping on the radio. Said, if I get back to that 12, he's getting crashed.
Right, yeah, they must have got into him.
You know, and you have to imagine this is something that's been going on for a couple corners. Blaney just doesn't turn guys for no reason. You have to go back and look and see if there's anything going on between the drivers in the past few corners there.
Denny Hamlin out in front, still has to come to pit road once it cycles through. It'll be Suarez and McDowell fighting for the lead here at Indy. Let's see which drivers are on the move, brought to you by Ashley Furniture. The two that are running up front, Brad Keselowski running second right now, Denny Hamlin running in the top spot. Both have gained 31 and 21 positions respectively.
So same goal for both of these cars. We are now closing in. This will be two laps to go in stage two. Remember, not racing to a yellow, but racing to the end of the stage, which will award points. The 11 of Denny Hamlin's yet to be on pit road, so this is an impressive stretch of his original fuel tank. We did have a yellow earlier for three extra caution flag laps. The 6 of Brad Keselowski, Dave, he pitted at lap 3 in this race. I think these two are battling for this stage.
That's right. Denny has the fourth most playoff points of anybody, so one more playoff point if he can win this stage. About 8 laps ago, Chris Gabart, his crew chief, asked him to go down the front straightaway at only 70% throttle. That was a couple of laps of that, and then 60% throttle, and then when Keselowski got to him, he said, okay, race him. We don't want the six to pass us. We want this stage win, Tim.
Well, Dave, a great strategy call by crew chief Matt McCall for Brad Keselowski. They started 22nd, so that caution during lap 3 brought him on to get enough fuel to get up to the end of stage 2, making sure they banked stage point. They thought maybe they would get the stage win. That's going to be hard with Hamlin still out there, but this is a big deal for this team. They came in 12 points below Kevin Harvick, who has the first playoff spot in on points. They are possibly able, depending on their finish, to hopscotch Harvick in the standings, which is a good thing with the real possibility that we could see 3 new winners before the end of the regular season and only one driver getting in on points.
This battle right here, this ain't over yet. We're coming to one to go in the stage. Then behind them, you have Suarez, McDowell, Chase Elliott. I don't think they'll get there, but they're coming fast, about a second, 2/10 a lap.
You should not need your switch this
one more lap to go.
Be prepared for it if you do.
In stage 2, and again, a caution won't come out, but they will earn points. After this lap, the top 10, and you see Denny Hamlin sliding into turn number 1, the pressure being put on by Keselowski.
He's got to worry about Keselowski, and he's also getting that information about his fuel. He has to switch the car to be able to get a little bit of reserve fuel. They're telling him he shouldn't need it, but he's got that on his mind. That is working on his mind, as well as looking behind him and seeing the 6 car.
And remember, if they want to get these points, they've got to cross the stripe, then make it another lap until they're able to come to pit road.
Denny Hamlin running out of
time. Oh, Denny missed the corner. He missed the corner big right there, slid the rear tires. Here comes Brad. Brad offline in the dirt. His tires are dirty. Here comes the 99. They're all right there.
How much will Suarez wait? Or will he be aggressive early? He looks to the inside now.
Be patient here, man. This is early in this race. I don't know if this is that critical. Oh, Brad's going to miss the corner. Here comes the 34 McDowell.
McDowell gets by the 99 of Suarez. McDowell now will be leading once these two come to pit road.
And Brad losing points, valuable points for the 6.
Stage win is going to go to Denny Hamlin. 5th stage win this year for him.
Now, Rick, to your point, as we see the 9 make a big move, he's going to look 3 wide into turn 1. The 11 of Hamlin needs to make it all the way back around to come to pit road.
And again, very tight on fuel for Denny Hamlin.
A lot of respect so far between these two through this very tight complex. Chase Elliott clears Suarez.
So now all of that. All of that right there cost Suarez a few spots to 2 cars that he's going to be racing for the win here.
And you see how many points through the stages these drivers have earned in the lower left corner of your screen. Very important for McDowell, who is not in on points. Suarez is not in. Chase Elliott not in.
So now, Flip, if you're Bubba Wallace, look now. Plus 30. You haven't done anything wrong. You came in with over 50 points, and these 2 cars behind you are having career road course days. You have to wonder if the 23 knows. I know they know it. Are they communicating it to Bubba, or are they letting him just stick with the plan?
Again, McDowell is going to take the top spot away from Denny Hamlin, and McDowell back out front at Indy.
What a great move by McDowell a lap ago to get this spot. Just a lot of patience exhibited. There goes the 11 car, Hamlin onto pit road.
Same with Brad Keselowski, also coming to pit road now. Now Chase Elliott has moved up to that 2nd spot. So it's McDowell, Elliott, and Suarez. 1, 2, 3. Kim.
And mission accomplished for Brad Keselowski. Although they would have liked to have won that stage or finished at least 2nd, still bank some stage points to pad their playoff position. Brad, super happy with the race car. No major complaints. Feel like they have a very solid car underneath them. 4 tires, Sunoco fuel for Brad Keselowski, Dave.
Masterful job of strategy and driving for the 11th team. He'll wait on
on the Sunoco fuel to make sure that car is full of fuel before it goes anywhere. No changes requested by the driver. Again, that one very valuable playoff point awarded to the 11 team.
Now the 11 and the 6 did the gamble, scored the points. Now a caution would be perfect. They're full of fuel and the freshest tire in the field.
You're watching the NASCAR Cup Series Verizon 200 at the Brickyard. NBC Sports coverage of NASCAR is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Save when you bundle auto, home, or motorcycle insurance. Visit progressive.com. And by Toyota. Let's go places. Speaking of going places, Michael McDowell out in front and almost missing the turn there as the 9 of Chase Elliott will close the gap even more.
This 9 car is the real deal today. He showed up at practice, showed up in qualifying, and lap after lap continues to inch his way into this battle. Now you see Brad Keselowski and Denny Hamlin with those fresher tires trying to recover, work their way back up through traffic. So everyone has made a pit stop now. So what you see for the running order is basically one stop required for everyone, right? You see McDowell, then you have Chase Elliott. Right off the rear bumper of Chase Elliott, the 99 of Suarez. As we were at break, this 8 has inched his way in. He's kind of joining this fight. You're going to see the whole front stretch kind of line up. Right then behind the 8, you have a little bit bigger gap back to Reddick. I think he's still a player. Bowman is behind Reddick. That's another car looking for a win. Oh, this traffic in front of McDowell is going to be tough.
Eric Jones in the 43 right in front of race leader Michael McDowell.
And we heard some potential transmission issues for the 43. We haven't got that confirmed, but some whispers on the radio. I don't know if that's the pace issue for the 43, but definitely touch off the pace. Oh, Marty.
So Rick, working lap 40 here. So Steve, when would you make that final stop of the day if you're the leaders? I'm hearing crew chiefs asking, how's the handling in your car? Pit crews kind of stretching out down here on pit road. Seems like we're getting close to what could be the final stop of the day.
We just saw Denny Hamlin go, what, 35 green plus some pace laps, or 33 green with some pace laps and some caution. So I would imagine we're gonna see cars on pit road. It's 43 to go right now in the race. You know, 35 to go is probably super aggressive. They'd probably like to see 33 or 32 to go. You basically, I think it would be hard pressed to pit outside your fuel window, probably right at it, or at least maybe within one lap of it. The risk just really isn't worth the reward if you're one of these three cars who already has track position.
McDowell has been out front 15 laps already today. Chase Briscoe running back in the 7th position, Marty.
Boy, what a day for Mitchell, Indiana's Chase Briscoe, who loves this racetrack. Came here when he was a kid, and in fact, in ride-arounds, as we ride on board with the HighPoint.com onboard camera, he said for the first time he came here in ride-arounds, for driver's introductions, he cried. That's how much this racetrack means to him. He has an Xfinity Series win. He needs a win on the Cup side to be able to make the playoffs, having a terrific showing up in the 7th position. Said he needs a little more rear lateral grip. The longer they run, that's what he loses.
That rear lateral grip makes it very hard. When you want to go to the throttle, you can't go to the throttle until the rear of the car settles down. If you try to do it, it's just going to spin those rear tires. Right here, you want to be wide open. Get to it quickly, lift off the gas, apply that throttle really smoothly as we ride along with Chase. Progressive telemetry, watch how smooth he is on that throttle. Wide open now. Easy on the throttle to that right-hander. Heavy braking into turn 12. Left-hander 13. Watch how smooth he is on the throttle. A little bit of throttle, a little bit of throttle, a little bit. Now wide open as he exits. Got to breathe in a little bit coming to the front straightaway. Shifting gears, a lot going on. You have to modulate it. You can't just make those rear tires mad. They get hot, they get overheated, and then they will not make grip. Kim.
So Kyle Busch currently running in the 4th position, but came on the radio and said,
SMT data, the car data. He says it sounds or feels draggy. Look at our top speed on the straightaways. If you have an engine issue, a valve spring or a top end issue, you're going to see it at the end of this, the back stretch, the end of the front stretch. A valve spring at a track like this, I can believe it. These cars and these engines have been pretty rock solid, but with all the downshifting, it's easy to mechanically over rev, which means you downshift at too high a speed and the electronics can't stop the RPM of the motor. It's simple math. The tires are turning faster in that gear than you need.
His last lap on the racetrack, over a second slower.
Man, keep digging for right now. We're talking to DCR guys now.
So they see or hear something. ECR is the engine provider.
You can see it in the lap time.
I'll listen when he comes back.
That's Richard Childers, car owner. And he loves that engine program, and he said he was going to listen. He thought if it was a valve spring, he would be able to hear that in the exhaust pipes when it came by him.
And he's going by pit road now, so we'll see if RC did hear something that didn't sound right.
Again, about a second off of what he and the leaders have been running.
We'll see Chase Elliott with Suarez behind him about 6-tenths of a second. Chase Elliott is 6-tenths of a second behind McDowell. Again, five laps from now would be aggressive if they came to pit road. 6 to 7 laps, they'd be able to fit right into their fuel window. Kim?
We're going to get a great look from Austin Dillon's Coca-Cola Zero Sugar on board. I talked to Austin this morning, and he said, we hope we can surprise people this weekend. This course has not been great for me. I've got two finishes of 30 or worse here. Right now, Austin very happy with that race car, saying he loves what they gave him this weekend. Currently running in the 15th position, and the team told me a top 15 is a solid day. A top 10 is a good day. We'll see if they can get there, break that top 10.
I've been impressed. Austin was one of the drivers that ran a little longer, didn't pit the lap 28, while other cars pitted in the teens. And you know, he's doing a really nice job, driven all the way up into the 15th position.
Again, Dillon running 15th. Out in front, Michael McDowell.
That's my team out there.
If our network goes down, lives are at stake.
Our comms have to work.
Or the mission won't.
That's why we partner with Verizon Frontline, the network that truly prioritizes first responders.
So we don't worry about getting through. And they're the most reliable 5G network in America.
Out here, reliability is everything.
Extreme or routine, Verizon Frontline delivers.
The number one network choice in public safety. It's your mission. It's your Verizon.
Well, I'm not 100% sold yet.
Okay, have you considered...
It's fine, Flo. She's not interested. I get it. Not everyone wants to save money.
What's she doing?
I don't know. Renters and homeowners can bundle and save. For what? A trip to Bora Bora? Bora boring.
Okay, you know what? I'm in.
She's all yours. Want some tacos?
Nah, I'm not really in the mood.
Yeah, you're right. It's so messy. All the napkins, those different toppings.
Actually, I'm in.
Yeah, you are.
Advance?
In Advance Auto Parts.
I need that diehard power.
And the reliability and rugged durability, right?
Yes.
That's why diehards choose diehard.
And Advance Auto Parts is the home of diehard. We'll even install yours for free.
Yeah. Hey. Abuela? She makes the best tamales.
This is how we advance.
Wow, you get to watch all your favorite stuff.
It's to die for, and it's all right here.
Streaming was never this easy, you know.
This is the way.
Really went all out, didn't you?
It's called commitment.
Can you turn on the volume?
Here, you can try.
Get way more into what you're into when you stream on the Xfinity 10G network.
Next week on NBC USA at Peacock, defending 200-meter world champion Noah Lyles leads the stars of Team USA as they take on the best athletes from around the world at the World Track and Field Championships. It's August 20th and 23rd on NBC USA and Peacock. Bell getting by Kyle Larson, and we just saw Shane Van Gisbergen go by Kyle Larson.
Yeah, he's been working on him, and finally down here in nine, he just dives down in there to make it happen.
And that's a super aggressive move. It's probably not something Larson was expecting. See right here, he just goes right.
Yep.
Just shortcuts the track, and Larson's like, well,
he
got spot now.
He did a good job there. I was expecting contact, you know what I mean? Typically, that'd be a pretty aggressive move, and there would be contact. Josh Blicky get turned around off the nose of Corey LaJoy, I believe.
Sure enough, into the grass, the 78 win. Now 37 laps to go as McDowell continues to lead. Shane Van Gisbergen back in ninth, Dave.
And Rick, this deal was not known a few weeks after the Chicago win for Shane. Crew chief Darian Grubb told me today, we got the call about a month ago, and we didn't know if we could do it. Remember, after Chicago, these cars got significant safety updates from NASCAR. They had to cut things out. They had to put new things in, and they didn't know if they could turn this same chassis around in time. But they got help. They got expedited work done, and they got this car turned around for Shane. The creature comforts, they're all the same, but this car's been updated, and it's still fast.
Yeah, he's been running some really fast laps, some of the fastest laps in the field, just like he did in Chicago. You know, started that race pretty much on par with everybody, but by the end of the race had a second on the field, just getting better and better as he understands the performance of the car and the racetrack and what it can do. His counterpart from the V8 Supercars, Kostecki's back in 18th place, having a great day in that backup car.
This battle right here, all three of these cars and drivers are so equal right now. It's almost a game of who's going to make a mistake. Suarez trying to put the pressure to Chase Elliott to force a mistake, Marty.
And Jeff, how crazy are the NASCAR playoffs? The top three all below the cut line. Five of the top 10 below the cut line. Everyone needing points. Everyone needing a win. Two laps from pit stop, Steve's there about. How do you separate yourself if you're trying to win and make your way into the playoffs as Daniel Suarez looks underneath Chase Elliott?
Yeah, this battle continues. Well, the first thing you have to do is not make a mistake. We've seen some speeding penalties on pit road, and you kind of almost have to decide, like right here, you see Chase kind of swerving, I think trying to break the draft of the 99 of Suarez. If the handling's starting to fall away, Dale, you know, you might come a lap earlier than you want. But you need to make sure you can make it to the end on fuel.
That's what I'm wondering about this 9. Right there, missing the curb. I don't think this car's driving so well. Looked like the best car earlier. The 99 was struggling. Now looks like it's flip-flopped a little bit. Chase barely hanging on here. This car moving around quite a bit.
Suarez almost got into him.
Suarez is so much better on approach to these corners, whether it's braking or what have you. The 9 missing a lot of apexes.
And while these two fight for the second spot, McDowell has put 1.3 seconds between himself and Elliott.
And this is 31 laps on this set of tires as the 9 misses another corner. 35 laps to go, you see in the upper left. So if you pit here, you got to expect about the same length run.
Suarez recognizes that Chase is in trouble, and so it's pressure. You see him into the back of the 9 car. Didn't knock him out of the way, but hey, man, I'm here. You're holding me up. Suarez just wants to keep applying pressure on these braking zones. This is where mistakes can happen.
That's a lot of pressure. He sends him out of the way.
Wow.
Suarez takes the spot from Chase Elliott.
I don't think Chase will be happy with that. That was excessive in my eyes, but Suarez got away with it. But now Chase says, all right, buddy, game on. I owe you one. Here it is. We're riding on board when it happened. Here's what it looked like. Corner entry, that contact. That's very difficult for Chase Elliott to handle without spinning out.
Yeah, neither car's made the curb. Both cars missed the corner, and Chase again lucky. Marty.
Terrific top 10 run going for Chase Briscoe, trying to fix that lateral grip issue kind of on the early side of the window with 34 laps to go in this race at Indianapolis. Kyle Larson also going to come down pit road. You see him on the bottom of your screen. He asked Cliff Daniels a while ago, how long do we have before we can pit? Remember, he has that flat spotted tire. He made it live all the way through this run. 34 to go. These stops, and I bet you see some other drivers coming down pit road this time, Dave.
Absolutely. Austin Cindric and Brody Kostecki. And Cindric said that he needed a little bit of help in the turn early in the run. They reduced the air pressure in those two front tires. Five car in pit road as well.
I would be shocked to see in the upper right 34 getting close to the entrance of pit road. I would think this would be the time the leaders have to come. There comes the 34 of McDowell, 99 of Suarez, 9 of Chase Elliott. Be efficient. Remember how much Suarez made up on McDowell on this pit entry lane last time. We'll see if he's able to make up any time here. Looks like the gap kind of continued now. A long, long pit lane. Don't try to get aggressive. Don't speed, Kim.
And Michael McDowell still complaining. Just needs a little bit more lateral grip, especially in the rights. The crew's going to go to work on that machine. Four tires, Sunoco fuel. Crew chief Travis Peterson told the spotter, make sure you're working with the other cars we're going to blend in with. They think that's the 11 and the 6. Talk to those spotters. Make sure they're going to give us room. Marty.
Midpoint of that run, Chase Elliott said, I love the balance right here. For me, it's all about keeping rear grip. And then almost coming down pit road, he said, I've got to protect that left rear. Whatever you can do to help me to protect that rear grip. That's the situation for Chase Elliott. A heads-up race against Daniel Suarez and his team. They have the number one pit stall because they won the pole. Suarez clearly better at the end of that run, but a long stop for the 99. Chase Elliott is going to go by. A disastrous stop here for Daniel Suarez and his team. Losing track position.
We've already seen the 9 off pit road. We had already seen the 34 of McDowell off pit road. The 45 of Tyler Reddick was seconds behind this battle, and he is all the way to the rear bumper of the 99 of Suarez. The absolute worst time to have an issue. 33 to go. Now it's back in the hands of the driver.
Steve, what were they trying to do with the 99? The jackman came around to the left side and jacked it up while they were fueling, but they weren't doing anything with the tires. Were they trying to put more fuel in it?
Oh, they shouldn't have to worry about that, though. This car should be able to get full, no problem being flat. So we got to just watch the entire stop. So the jack comes to the left side. Looks pretty normal. A little bit of slow on the left front. Tires on. Tires tight. Oh, there's your issue right there, Rick. Front hose. Look at the man right here. He's standing here. Hose underneath the tire, right? He says, I cannot leave until you jack the left side up. It's as simple as that. If we watch that again, when that car comes in and stops, that front hose has to be clear of those front tires. It creeps underneath the left front when the jack is dropped. Look at the frustration. Hundreds and hundreds of pit stops you practice for those little things. Man, what a bad time. So let's watch right here. We're going to watch it nice and slow. Look at this hose. So right there, you saw it. There's a loop in the hose. If we back up about 5 or 6 frames, you see the loop right here. That's not normal. That should be all stretched out there nice and straight. As he comes around, it creates a loop. It seems so small. It's like it catches his right leg, and it actually lassoes itself. And what happens is the left front tire is on it. He's lucky there's enough air pressure to take the nut off. The gun could shut off this way. You jack it up, and now you see the gap. The problem is nobody's going to recognize it. The tire carrier steps, moves in a little bit more. Game over for the 99. Actually, great job of the jackman. Look, I know it's slow, but this could have been, you know, a 30, 40-second disaster. You see the frustration behind pit wall. Big miscue for the 99. Now it's time to recover. Let's hear what they have to say.
So I need your head down. I need you to go get these spots. Come on. We're going to put it on your back today. You're going to go get it done.
And then after that, I love the leadership from Travis Mack, who came on the radio, said, listen, I want you to take a deep breath, Daniel. This is all going to cycle out. We should be in the third position. Steve, you worked with Travis Mack for a long time. Dale Jr. doing the best he can to lead this team, keep his driver calm, and keep him focused. They've earned a lot of stage points. Top 5 still could be in the offing today.
Well, that's the key, guys, right? Like, if this isn't a must win, while a win would be great, those stage points has made the day relatively successful. Let's not run somebody over, run off track, wreck our car trying to get back up there. There's still 31 laps to go in this race.
Well, I love the fact they said, hey, we're going to put it on your shoulders. We trust you. You're going to bail us out. I love that. That's saying, hey, man, we messed up, but we got the best driver. Go get it done. And that is unlike that team. That has been throughout the year the best, the eighth best pit crew on pit road. Just a small miscue, and it's going to be costly.
Last wave of green flag cycle underway. Bell leads Wallace. McDowell, though, fresh tires and full of tanks, running third. He can go to the finish.
Wow, you get to watch all your favorite stuff.
It's to die for, and it's all right here.
Streaming was never this easy, you know.
This is the way.
Really went all out, didn't you?
It's called commitment.
Can you turn on the volume?
Here, you can try.
Get way more into what you're into when you stream on the Xfinity 10G network.
Why did we choose SafeLight?
For us, driving around is the only way we can get our baby to sleep. So when our windshield cracked,
we can't drive this.
We needed it fixed right. We went to SafeLight.com. There's no one else we'd trust. Their experts replaced our windshield and recalibrated our car's advanced safety system. They focus on our safety, so we can focus on this little guy.
SafeLight Repair, SafeLight Replace.
Let Innovation Refunds help with your ERC tax refund so you can improve your business however you see fit. Rosie used part of her refund to build an outdoor patio. Blink. Dr. Marshall used part of his refund to give his practice a facelift. Emily used part of her refund to buy.
I run a wax museum.
Let Innovation Refunds help you get started on your ERC tax refund. Stop waiting. Go to innovationrefunds.com.
You really got the brows.
Doug. What do we always say, son? Liberty Mutual customizes your car insurance.
So you only pay for what you need.
That's my boy. And you get out there and you make us proud, huh?
Bye, Uncle Emu.
Stay off the freeways.
Only pay for what you need.
Liberty, 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 liberty.
A big show is coming. We're ready to go racing. Yeah. Time to bring the action.
Go, 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 go. Never give up, never give up.
Newgarden wins back-to-back. Alex does it again. Around the outside for the lead level. Here we go. That's action packed.
Hey NASCAR fans, it's Anthony Mackie and Stephanie Beatrice from the new Peacock original series, Twisted Metal.
Let's just say in this world, you gotta be at least as fast as a NASCAR driver if you wanna survive.
Check out Twisted Metal, streaming now, only on Peacock.
Fans, make sure to download the official app of NASCAR. You can follow the racing action with free live scoring in car cameras, as well as a radio broadcast. Search NASCAR in your app store. And make sure to start a free trial today. You're watching the NASCAR Cup Series Verizon 200 at the Brickyard with just 29 laps to go.
See Bubba Wallace leaving pit road, doing a nice job. Fender's still on it. Car's still looking good. And as we take a look at the running order with 29 laps to go, Michael McDowell, Elliott, Suarez, Reddick, all off pit road with enough fuel to make it to the finish. Hamlin, Keselowski, they're a little off strategy. We're expecting a pit stop out of the fifth and sixth place cars. Kyle Busch in seventh has enough fuel, potential engine issues. Kobayashi still has to make a pit stop. Bowman, Briscoe, Truex, Larson, all off pit road. So those are kind of your players. Right now it's McDowell with a nice lead, over 3 seconds. What a run by Michael McDowell and this organization on the week where they said, these are our drivers. Yep. McDowell and Gilliland, we're going to continue to build. So, so impressive. I know he won the Daytona 500, and that was a monumental day for this young man, or veteran driver, to be quite honest. Mm-hmm. 450 starts. But if he can come and win on this road course, needing to make the playoffs, this would be huge.
Michael McDowell is a fighter. You think about his career, first about 10 years or so, he didn't even run a full-time season. And he kind of drove cars that were not very competitive, and he just kept grinding and grinding and grinding, and here he is. There's a lot of work left to do with 28 to go. Let's be clear. A lot of stuff can happen, but Michael McDowell knows how to go fast in a race car, and he has found a way to persevere and keep going when a lot of people would have quit. It's good to see a guy with that much fight having a shot to win this race.
Car owner Bob Jenkins for Front Row Motorsports has stuck it out, ground his way through many years running toward the back half of the field, finally seeing his organization become a front runner. We've seen him run good at road courses. We've seen him win at super speedways, but this is legit speed. They drove up, taking the lead, led many laps today. They're putting themselves in a great position to make the playoffs on performance alone. It's incredible what this team has done to get better.
Remember, they lost their crew chief. Blake Harris was the crew chief a year ago. He moved over to Hendrick Motorsports. Travis Peterson takes over this 34 car. And we've seen some great strategy calls and things like that, but for raw speed, this is the most impressive run we've seen for the 34.
Travis Peterson was an engineer at Hendrick at one point. Came from Junior Motorsports, was an engineer on one of my cars for a while. Finally found himself an opportunity as a crew chief and is doing an incredible job with this team this year.
So again, McDowell out in front. He has a 3.5 second lead over Chase Elliott. 39 cars started the race, 39 still running. Three are off the pace just a bit, a lap down with Bilicki, Logano, and Haley. Corey LaJoy right now running in the 34th position, and Corey has a few special guests that have joined that team on the pit box.
Yeah, Rick, one of the cool things about the crossover weekend, look who's hanging out on Corey LaJoy's pit box. Colton Herta, who's won here at the road course before. Kyle Kirkwood won a few weeks ago on the streets of Nashville, won Long Beach earlier this year. So I just talked to both of them, and I said, hey, 28 laps to go. You going to get out of here and beat the traffic? They said, no way, man. This race is too cool. They're enjoying it, and they didn't have to be here today. They came out on their own volition. Of course, Andretti Autosport to Cambridge, having a closer relationship with Spire. I asked Colton, is that going to bring you to the race track more? He said, I would love to. I asked Kyle, what cup race would you like to run? He said, I would love to run Miami. That's my home track. But Junior, I asked Colton Herta, what race would you want to run? He said, Daytona. But only if Junior gives me some lessons. So are you up for some lessons for Colton Herta? Maybe get him in the car for the Daytona 500.
Hey, what an honor that would be. And all of these guys, every time, you know, and they're all mostly, right, road course specialists, right? That's their expertise. They all want to run ovals. When they come to NASCAR, they want to go to Daytona. They want to go to ovals. Kyle Busch had a little issue out on the racetrack as he's trying to find pace in this car with the engine issues. He's about a second off, so he's having to do everything he can in the braking zones and through the turns to get speed or any kind of pace out of this car.
Larson just went by him, and we were talking and looking at as we have an issue here. Ricky Stenhouse Jr. just in front of that 15 of Jensen Button. But Kyle Larson had just gone by Kyle Busch. And you look at the issue that took place here, a little contact there. Maybe a little bit more here. Maybe a lot more there.
Just a little arguing Ricky going on. Yeah, Ricky's like, ah.
He sent him.
Yeah. Talking about Kyle Busch trying to make pace, so let's take a look. Just locking up that tire, and that's not a track, that's not a corner where you typically see lock up, but he's actually just pushing as hard as he can in all the corners to be able to try to find speed, and he has to drive the car differently when it's down on power.
Yeah, well, when he downshifts also, it doesn't slow the car down like it does when it's full power, and now he's going to continue to lock it up, so it locks it up. And, oh, he's missed a groove. Now he's got to come down here and stop. What happens is once you flat spot that tire, and now it literally puts a flat spot on it. And now it seems like every time you go to brake, it finds that flat spot, and it just continues to slide it. Here he comes to pit road.
I think you heard him say tires, needs tires.
Yeah, bring it down. Four tires, guys, four tires.
One of the hardest braking zones as far as car balance, because you're still kind of turning, which unloads that right front tire, and you can almost see it just skipping across the pavement right there. And this is a good decision. If you know it's that easy to lock up, come put fresh tires on it. If you continue, that tire will finally fail. You'll slide all the way through the tire, and then it could be heavy damage.
One
pit road, and race leader McDowell is just coming through turn 11 right now. So it looks like Kyle could stay out in front of the leader and stay on the lead lap. It will be close as he's coming off of pit road, and McDowell making his way right now through 12 and 13.
And it's just a long, such a long pit road. But as we are covering that with the eight, I will say the last two laps, the nine car has taken this lead to under 3 seconds. So with 25 laps to go, we saw this in the IndyCar race yesterday, that battle between Scott Dixon and Ray Hall. Green flag running to the end. We'll see this time between McDowell and Chase Elliott.
24 to go here at Indy.
We've come a long way in 125 years. From dirt tracks to super speedways and every track in between. Never backing down, pushing boundaries, and giving it everything we've got. Yeah, we've come a long way, but there's still a lot more road to run. Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR.
That's my team out there.
If our network goes down, lives are at stake.
Our comms have to work.
Or the mission won't.
That's why we partner with Verizon Frontline, the network that truly prioritizes first responders.
So we don't worry about getting through. And they're the most reliable 5G network in America.
Out here, reliability is everything.
Extreme or routine, Verizon Frontline delivers.
The number one network choice in public safety. It's your mission. It's your Verizon.
With Wendy's BOGO Dollar Deal, your dollar never tasted so good. So everyone's going to get
Dave's
spicy chicken sandwich and a nugs.
I was going to say a frosty and a frosty.
You can do that.
Willie's really smart.
Choose wisely. Choose Wendy's buy one, get one for a buck.
Ashley's Labor Day sale is your last chance to save big on summer's top styles. With 0% interest for 60 months, shop Labor Day hot buys all just $5.98 each. And featured finds starting at only $17 per month or $9.99.99. Only at Ashley.
Summer won't last forever, but during Toyota's national sales event, you can make memories that will.
Okay, fine.
Come on.
There you go.
Where's my mom? Just be in the moment.
Yeah, just be present.
Toyota, let's go places.
Wow, fancy.
Get ready for the first ever Team Reba.
I have the fire, Team Legends ready to win.
I've got the fan base gonna set living rooms on fire.
I've collaborated with all kinds of musicians. I've lived the dream.
See y'all this fall.
Reba McEntire joins The Voice this fall on NBC.
Lead. Gibbs is going to win at Indianapolis.
Spin to win. Dixon has done it in Indy.
Never count this guy out.
Jet Lawrence keeps the perfect season alive. He wins the race, and with it, the 450 National Motocross Championship.
What a weekend of motorsports on the NBC Sports family of networks. The IndyCar win for Scott Dixon, his first win of 2023. That makes it 19 straight years for the Iceman to get a win. Then the youth movement happened here also at Indianapolis with Ty Gibbs getting the win in the Xfinity Series race. But you talk about youth movement. How about Pro Motocross? 20-year-old Jet Lawrence clinched the Pro Motocross Championship in his rookie season with his 18th straight win. Can he finish the season undefeated? If so, he would be only the third ever rider to go undefeated in the outdoor series. The two other, our very own Ricky Carmichael and James Stewart. A fantastic weekend. 22 laps to go here in the Cup Series race with Michael McDowell out front. Rick, let's talk about the Ruoff Mortgage keys to victory lane.
Yeah, number one, will it go green? Guys are kind of spread out a little bit, but brakes are getting hot. Cars aren't driving well. Who's going to make a mistake to bring that caution out?
Yeah, and if it comes out, who has the right strategy? Everybody's kind of married to their final green flag pit stop when we look at the front three or four cars. But if the yellow comes out, dude, you need tires.
And then the bubble battle with Michael McDowell leading this race. A win there would lock him into the playoffs. That would move Bubba Wallace to 16th in points, and he could lose half of his points cushion today to third running Daniel Suarez. Bubba right now in 20th position.
I thought we were getting ready to get that caution. Todd Gillen exits turn 11. Car gets loose, overcorrects, contact with the wall. Gets the car stopped. Ends up getting into pit lane. So big transition from the flat to the banking, and just got away from him.
Very similar to what we saw Brody Kostecki do in qualifying. The transition there, the bottoming out, all kinds of things happening as they get up on that banking there in turn 11.
We ride along with Ben Gisbergen, and just behind him is Chris Buescher, who has won the last two races of the Cup Series. Let's go through the field, brought to you by eBay. Kim, start us off.
I talked to leader Michael McDowell this morning, and he said people have underplayed what this team has been able to accomplish. With our smaller resources, we should not be contending with the JGRs and the Hendricks, but we are. And he said it's fun, but it's also nerve-wracking. He said the more nervous than I've ever been, but he likes it. He said he feeds off of that nervous energy. And Marty, I can't think of it. Anything that would make you more nervous than a seven-time road course winner in your rearview mirror.
McDowell desperate for a win. Chase Elliott desperate for a win as well. Steve mentioned a moment ago he has been cutting into McDowell's lead. Why? Here's a hint. Listen.
Your gear selection change is not hurting you back there. That's positive.
There you go, changing the way he's shifting gears on the backstretch, and they've started catching McDowell a little bit. That pit stop a moment ago for Daniel Suarez, the last stop of the day so far. Maybe there's one more. Cost him 10 seconds on the track. Suarez saying, I just need rear grip. That's what he needs the longer they run, and he is now 9 seconds behind McDowell. And Tyler Reddick came on the radio a little while ago, said the handling of the car is not bad. I just don't have the speed I thought we would have today, and we also need a little bit of track position as well. He's in the fourth spot, Dave.
Alex Bowman is not giving up in the fifth spot. He has passed two cars in the last two laps. And his crew chief, Blake Harris, told me this morning, we could win this week or next week. Alex is really good, and we are good as well. He said, I just want him to get to the end so he has a chance to fight, Kim.
And Dave, riding behind Alex in the sixth position is Brad Keselowski, and they are on an opposite strategy. They still have to make their final pit stop of the day. Their goal was to score more points than Kevin Harvick. They did that by staying out, grabbing points at the end of stage two. So this team should be expected on pit road before the end of the race, Marty.
Fun battle watching Chase Briscoe and these guys try and swap up the eighth position. Briscoe right now in that eighth spot. He told me, I can find another gear here at Indianapolis. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's because his hometown's about an hour from the racetrack. Population 4,300 in Mitchell, Indiana. And today, over 100 friends and family here as Denny Hamlin starts to come down pit road in front of you, Dave.
And Marty, we knew this was going to happen because he pitted on lap 36. Having qualified 25th, crew chief Chris Gabehart told me, I need things to fall our way today. They have not. He's got to pit out of position for the final time today, and he'll lose all the track position he had, Rick.
Yeah, stage two winner, though, so he did get a playoff point, which he can carry into the playoffs and then through each round if he is able to proceed from round to round. And that was a big thing for him, coming in wanting as many playoff points as he could get. You see the battle still all around the racetrack for position.
Yeah, that green and white number six right there, Brad Keselowski. He's going to have to come to pit road, but in front of him, Bell, Larson behind him, SVG, and Buescher in the 17. Those are all for position.
Shane Van Gisbergen running in the 11th spot right now. As you mentioned, Keselowski, who's in front of him, will have to come to pit road here. Just a few laps, 19 to go, and Gisbergen's going to get by Keselowski. Buescher as well.
Right at the back of this, that 12 of Ryan Blaney has put some really nice laps together.
And right there, as you called him out, You see the tire lock up. There's Keselowski making his way onto pit road. We haven't seen the 12 near the 16 since their incident on track.
The last car in line, we haven't said his name, I think, yet today. At 41 of Ryan Preece is a lap down. Kim.
And like we talked about, Brian Keselowski making his final stop of the day. They were on a completely opposite strategy under green flag conditions right now, looking for a very smooth stop. Crew chief Matt McCall reminding the team, no mistakes here. Four tires, Sunoco fuel for Brad, who has loved his car all day.
Brad coming off pit road. A career day as far as laps led for Michael McDowell. 36 laps led already. Listen into the radio.
Be smooth, do what you're doing. You're beginning to drive away.
Just give me gap. How many laps to go? No more feedback, please.
How about that? No more feedback.
That's the best thing a crew chief can hear, right? He wants gap, back to Elliott, and no more information. It's crystal clear what I have to do. I don't need to talk to you anymore. That's my information. 18 laps to go.
Yeah, how do you do these last 18 laps? You focus one corner at a time. Right now, the focus is turn one. How do I get by this eight car? How do I do it cleanly? It's just one corner at a time. You can't think about lap. You know, you can't think about the next lap or the next lap or even the end result. You have to connect all the dots, hit every mark, do everything right for the next 17 laps, and that's corner by corner. And some drivers just want to focus. They don't want anybody talking to them. Just let me do my job.
Think of the time these guys have been in the car, right? We had that one really early yellow, but since then it's been green flag. 60 straight laps of green flag racing.
Looks like Jensen Button and Ricky Stenhouse Jr. having some more contact on the racetrack. So this is down into turn seven. So the 15 misses the corner. Doors the 47 hard.
Jensen Button, an F1 champion. They don't do that in F1. There would be a penalty for that.
But if you remember, the 47 spun the 15 earlier. So maybe a little payback there.
Absolutely.
Sure, there's some anger involved.
On board with Kamui Kobayashi. He's like, man, this is fun to watch, but I don't want to be any part of what you guys have going on. 93 minutes. Green flag racing, over an hour and a half. And you know, you can say, well, they had two pit stops. Well, that's not a break. You have to focus on your pit road speed. Basically, you get about 10 seconds while you're sitting in the
Whoa!
And Ricky Stenhouse Jr. sends Kamui Kobayashi.
Yeah, what is happening here? So Ricky needs to get about three or four more and he'll have them all. All the international drivers. Patrick.
Trying to be perfect. And we see the 47 charging in a little bit too hard. Gets in the back of the 67 and around goes Kamui Kobayashi.
Hey, and one more.
No, I think we got it.
Yeah, let's focus on the RV.
Come on. RV?
Okay, everybody look at the RV and smile.
This is what you want for your family portrait.
Good point. We bundled the boat with our home and auto first. Mm-hmm. Hey, team, get on in here.
Team? Oh, fun.
Now everyone say 24-7 financial protection with Progressive. 24-7 financial protection with Progressive.
Okay.
Let's get some singles and me on the bike. Honey?
Yeah.
Wow, you get to watch all your favorite stuff.
It's to die for, and it's all right here.
Streaming was never this easy, you know.
This is the way.
Really went all out, didn't you?
It's called commitment.
Can you turn on the volume?
Here, you can try.
Get way more into what you're into when you stream on the Xfinity 10G network.
Advance?
In Advance Auto Parts.
I need that diehard power.
And the reliability.
And rugged durability, right?
Yes. That's why diehards choose diehard.
And Advance Auto Parts is the home of Die Hard. We'll even install yours for free.
Yeah. Hey. Abuela? She makes a list of tamales.
This is how we advance. Let Innovation Refunds help with your ERC tax refund so you can improve your business however you see fit. Rosie used part of her refund to build an outdoor patio.
Blink.
Dr. Marshall used part of his refund to give his practice a facelift. Emily used part of her refund to buy.
I run a wax museum.
Let Innovation Refunds help you get started on your ERC tax refund. Stop waiting. Go to innovationrefunds.com. You really got the brows.
It's your last chance to punch your tickets to Vegas. What a battle!
I'm going for the $1 million. Vegas, here I come.
Vance Walker, what power!
Oh, it's gonna be close!
American Ninja Warrior, Monday on NBC.
Big Ten football is coming to NBC and Peacock. First stop is Happy Valley as West Virginia will visit Penn State on September 2nd, the premiere of Big Ten Saturday night. Let's take a look at the Toyota driver updates. And you see Tyler Reddick running in the fourth position right now. Martin Truex Jr. seventh. And Bell also a part of the top 10 as they run.
Tyler Reddick, very fast, trying to take the fight. Suarez, a little further back though. Ty Gibbs in a 54 car. We saw him. He got caught up in that wreck early in the race. He has continued to fight. And here he is on the bumper of Austin Cindric. Remember, he's in this battle for the playoffs. Every spot matters. He's got a very fast race car. He's roped himself back up to 14th. So a good fight by Ty Gibbs. Didn't quit, didn't lay down, and now trying to get by Cindric.
Two Xfinity Series champions running here nose to tail. Dave.
Yeah, I like that, Rick. They both won that championship. They'd like to win this one. Here goes Ty Gibbs to the inside. Oh, is he going to have enough room? They're going to still stay side by side, and Gibbs is going to have to back off. Remember, he won yesterday. Confidence to this young man, and he's showing it right now, racing Cindric.
Takes a spot away from Austin, and so Ty Gibbs now moving up into the 13th position.
That's pretty impressive, being able to work that outside. Turn 12. To have the opportunity in turn 13 and shows you the kind of pace they have. The confidence he has as a driver.
Just not the cautions that he needed to get caught back up. He's got plenty of speed.
Steve's got a couple more spots right there in front of him. He's going to go after Blaney.
I'm starting to look at guys like that, Junior, right, that had speed, just haven't got this field bunched back up. And I mean, your heart has to break for Daniel Suarez, right? He came in, had that hose underneath the left front tire, rejoined way behind, 8, 9, almost 10 seconds behind the leader. He's closed his gap down to 6.5 seconds, but, you know, he's going to need some help. This is a guy that came in needing a great day. He started on the pole, was overtaken by McDowell, and he closed to the rear bumper of McDowell in the first set of green flag pit stops, doing a great job, and actually leapfrogged the 34. Had a little pushing and shoving with the 9 car, and then really the moment for the 99, which ruined the day so far, was this, the air hose underneath the left front. You see the 99 driving by on pit lane. They still have to change tires. It's just heartbreak for Daniel Suarez. It's still 12 to go. You get a caution, he's gonna be right back into this, but continues once again faster than both McDowell and Elliott that lap.
Now McDowell getting into a little bit of traffic here that he'll have to negotiate around.
Yeah, he was losing a little bit of time to the 9 of Chase Elliott. That shrunk down to less than 3 seconds, but then started beating Chase's time. But this traffic right here is going to cost him a little bit. He's got to work through.
Getting by Mike Rockefeller there in the 42.
And that's what you want as a leader. You know, he showed Rockefeller he wanted the spot. Mike gave him some respect, didn't push him, didn't fight him very hard. Now he's on Kobayashi. He's hoping for the same thing right here. Do not hold me up, please. I'm the leader.
So far, we have seen the international drivers be very respectful of the regulars.
Kabui does a good job there, allowing a 34 through.
And now Rockenfeller trying to get by Kamui Kobayashi. Marty.
Speaking of Mike Rockenfeller in the 42, last week Noah Gregson was suspended indefinitely by NASCAR after apparently liking a racially derogatory image on social media. Then on Thursday of this week, Legacy Motor Club and Noah Gregson put out a joint statement saying that Gregson had requested to be released from his contract. In the statement, Gregson said, quote, I love racing and I'm looking forward to a second chance to compete for wins at the highest level of NASCAR and most importantly, make my family, my team, and the fans proud of me once again. Rockenfeller not only in this week as Kamui Kobayashi tries to track him down, but also next week at Watkins Glen for Rockenfeller. Much more, Rick, to come on this story as the weeks develop.
Yeah, Marty, and it was a Monday, as you mentioned, a Monday call, and Rockenfeller was in the United States. He was at Road America. He and his family, which consists of his three kids, age 2, 7, and 9, all rode back from Road America to Charlotte, almost a 15-hour car ride to get back, get his seat fitted in the 42, spend a little time with the team to understand exactly what he was going to have as an undertaking. But the call came from, you know, co-owner of Legacy Motor Club, Jimmy Johnson, who had run with him in Garage 56 when they were together for the Le Mans race. We see Van Gisbergen here tracking down Christopher Bell. That's for ninth.
These two are tired of each other.
Yeah, I was going to say, Chris faced each other all day.
Christopher's like, man, this guy again.
He's been on his bumper. You know, a different experience.
Oh, big moment right there. Wow.
A different experience for Shane in this race. You know, he came into Chicago, and his background had a lot of street racing, right? And so he came there, and he's a little more comfortable than all the other guys. For everybody else, it was very strange, very weird. And he came in there and he was comfortable and he had speed from the minute they unloaded and got on racetrack. He's been fast this week for sure, sitting there running 10th, obviously very good, but now he's getting a little bit more of the full NASCAR experience and how good these regular drivers are.
And while Rockenfeller and a few of these other drivers are here for a one-off, this guy might be somebody we see more often going into next season. Going to finish out the supercars this year, but he wants to come back. He wants to race more in the Cup Series. He wants to make a career, albeit a brief one. I don't know how many, you know, years he could possibly run in the Cup Series and have success, but he definitely wants to give it his best opportunity and come out here and make it work.
If he's going to do it, they're going to have to find a way for him to get oval experience, not at the Cup level. If you took him, you know, he went to the truck race the other night at Indianapolis Raceway Park. You know, ran in the you know, the low 20s, high teens. If he's going to race on Sundays with these guys at Michigan's, at Charlotte's, at those places, he is going to have a ton of work to do. So you got to find a way to do it. Trucks, Xfinity, late models, whatever it is, before you expose him to that at this level.
And they're comparing his entry into NASCAR sort of like Marcus Ambrose. You got to remember, Marcus ran trucks. He had a long sort of runway into the Cup Series. It wasn't just a year or two, a crash course, if you will, to figure these ovals out. So it'll be quite an impressive thing. It's ambitious for what he wants to do, but definitely going to try to make it work. And we'll see if he'll come back next year and run some more races with us. This battle right here is tightened right up, this 99 car of Suarez.
You see Reddick to the inside in the 45 and trying to take that spot away. Again, that's for third.
Now they're going to run through here, almost contact. Reddick did not want to give it up. He wanted to maintain position. Look at him working the car. He was offline, a lot of dirt on them tires, trying to work them tires clean so he can perform in the braking zone here.
Under 10 laps to go in this race, coming up on 8 to go.
Good speed out of this 45 right here late in the race, and he too would probably love to see a caution to give him an opportunity at the front two.
You mentioned a guy looking for a caution, the 9 of Chase Elliott, second, started third, has run at the front all day long, 2.5 seconds back, and this is a guy that has 7 road course wins to his career, but all in the old generation of car. 7 wins and 11 starts, unbelievable. But since the move to the next gen car, Levin starts 0 wins, 144 laps led, but the stats are a little off. He has 5 top 5s in 8 races, and he's well on his way. The same sort of speed again for the 9 car. So the interesting thing is, you know, those top fives have come to different winners. SVG won them. We've seen Reddick win the races. Now you have Michael McDowell, right? It's not like he's losing to the same car. Back when he won those 7 races, it was like Elliott Truex. Now it's like a different cast of characters in front of him each and every road course race, but only one spot.
Yeah, you see the names that he's amongst as far as most road course wins. Now, there are more road course races being run now, but Steve, you mentioned the numbers not quite spelling out the whole story, because his average is the best. I mean, his average finish is really good. He just hasn't been to victory lane as often as what we had seen in those first 11 road course starts.
And he's hovering right around 2.5 seconds behind McDowell. He's a little bit quicker. You have to imagine, though, who's pushing harder. Is McDowell pushing harder? Is he running just enough not to make mistakes? You have to imagine Chase Elliott is giving us everything he has, Marty.
As you can imagine, all the spotters around the track for the 9 are saying, hey, there's debris everywhere. They do need that caution. But talking to Alan Gustin this morning, he said, here at Indianapolis, I think Chase is still learning this track. In fact, in the middle of the race last year, he told the team that, I'm still picking up what to do. Watkins Glen next week, that's the track they have the most confidence in. Chase has 2 wins there, maybe should have been 3 had his teammate Kyle Larson not moved him out of the way at the end of the race last year. McDowell out front right now, but Chase Elliott feels very good about next week, Kim.
Well, Marty, the communication to McDowell has been very minimal. They just have been telling him the interval to Chase every lap, but the communication between crew chief Travis Peterson and spotter Clayton Hughes has ratcheted up. Take a listen.
Point 8-9 has the same traffic to deal with, driving away. Gotta find these spotters and get them the out of the way. They're not helping us enough.
So the intensity has ratcheted up for crew chief Travis Peterson, talking about the lapped cars on the track, making sure the spotters from McDowell are getting the track clear for their driver to have a smooth last 7 laps here at Indy.
Big, big corner back there of turn 7. Just about missed turn 7 entirely in that 34 car.
And Junior, one thing to bring up with 7 laps to go is we expected all these pit stops around lap 49 to be inside their fuel window. But remember,
47 out of the way.
You hear more than that, want some help with that 47. It'll be interesting to see. They're going to be close on fuel. I think everyone can make it, but you wonder if anyone in the field is sweating, right? Did they get their car completely full? Are they running harder this time? We've seen cars go this far. We'll see if anybody has issues in the closing laps.
A little further back in the field, Andy Lally, Mike Rockenfeller. Rockenfeller on the inside, contact, moves Lally out of the way.
McDowell finally around the 47 car in the break zone of turn 1. Now there are 3 lap cars between your leader McDowell and Chase Elliott.
Three cars between, tell him on the back, 2.3, 3 cars between.
That's good information.
That's McDowell's team. That's something to comfort him. Hey, there's a lot of traffic between y'all. Just relax here, 6 to go, coming to 5 laps to go for the 34.
You said relax, and I think that's the right word. Like, I didn't like that. Get him out of the way, move that guy, get the spotter to move that guy. Like, just let him do his job. You know, there's no need to give reason to panic to the driver. It's about hitting your marks right now.
Well, we have to remember, too, there's a second channel. There's a lot of that communication is happening on. I'm sure the driver's probably not hearing most of that frantic communication. That would be terrible for the driver to have to deal with trying to get around, negotiate this racetrack.
Well, one thing, this panic, you want to talk about panic? Mike McDowell winning changes that whole bubble conversation. I mean, look at the bottom left, right? We talked about 3 points, 5 points, all of those things. But McDowell, if he can hold on to this win, he jumps up. He will end up in yellow. You see leader next to his name right now. That puts Bubba at plus 28. Bubba's having a fine day. He's doing everything he can. He's running 18th, Marty.
Yeah, Steven, that's the frustrating part. Absolute worst case scenario for 23-11 and Bubba Wallace. They did not need a new winner. Right now, McDowell out front, and in 5 laps could be a new winner. But Steve, what do you do? He and Booty Barker came in with a plan, just have a solid day. They've done that. They've had a very solid day. Bubba Wallace right now in 18th. Not spectacular. They did what they needed to do, but the new winner just changes the game.
Well, you just have to execute the plan you laid out. This isn't race 1 or 2. right? We've run well over 20 races at this point. The regular season is a long time. You just now have to try to close it out. Oh, man, we have a car off in the gravel.
That's the 16 of AJ. He's going to be able to get to the pavement wherever he's at. Looks like he's on the runway for a minute.
Yeah, stays at speed.
Pretty frustrating day for AJ.
The thing about, Bubba Wallace come into this race plus 58 to the cut line, so he could possibly lose about half of that cushion. And the 99 of Daniel Suarez gaining 29 points at Michigan. Nobody saw that happening. And then having another incredible day here, 17 points earned already, regardless of where he finishes. Made this bubble battle compelling. It's been awesome the last several weeks to talk about it and to watch it happen. Chase Elliott still with those lap cars between them. Just about 2 seconds, a little over 2 seconds back as we see AJ off track back there. He did a good job, I know some people running around this racetrack would love to see a caution. AJ did a good job, veteran, to be able to get through that gravel back on the racetrack, keep it going.
Michael McDowell out in front. And remember, he has one career win at the highest level of stock car racing, and it came at the biggest race, the Daytona 500 back in 2021, as the 2 and the 22 wrecked. The 34 of McDowell, the seas parted, he went through and was able to stay out front and get the win. Chase Elliott finished second to him, but what a huge celebration it was for McDowell to get that win. Now, he has been the dominant driver with the dominant car here today at Indianapolis.
I saw these boys are calm down around here. It's giving me a heart attack with these going off track and stuff.
That is certainly Channel 2. There is no way that Michael McDowell is listening to that. But, guess who ran second that day of the 500? Chase Elliott.
Right now, 2 seconds behind McDowell. That gap has not gotten any smaller.
And Chase hasn't really been able to run down and get around these lap cars either. They're not slow cars by any means. You can see they're hanging right around.
0.4, two cars between.
And again, it's about hitting your marks, not making mistakes. Everything that you've done to this point, just keep doing it. Even if it's a couple tenths, 3 tenths slower, those high risk areas, heavy braking zones into 1, into 7, into 12, back it up just a touch. Make sure you don't get yourself in trouble. It's hard to do when you're in this rhythm that McDowell's in, been in it all day. It's hard to change it. It's hard to get conservative. Sometimes when people get conservative, they actually make mistakes. You as a driver got to decide, how hard am I going to push? And what am I comfortable doing? Am I better off just keep attacking the racetrack, or do I want to back it up?
And Jeff, you bring a great point as far as the focus that these drivers have had to have throughout this entire race. Because remember, the only caution that has come out during this race was on lap 2. So they have gone, they're closing in on going 80 laps of green flag racing here at Indianapolis Motor Speedway on the road course. Having to maintain that focus and not make mistakes for so many turns, Kim.
And while you would think that those caution breaks that we used to have would allow a driver to reset, I asked Michael specifically about this morning. Can you catch your breath? Do you need to? And he said, I actually prefer no stage caution because they allow me to stay in my rhythm. And here is a rhythm track. These road courses, they are rhythm tracks. This works to my advantage, and we're seeing that here today.
Under 2 laps to go. 1.8 seconds to gap between 1 and 2.
And now Michael McDowell just wants to see that white flag. Yeah. He knows when he sees that white flag, it kind of goes back into his hands. He has to finish out the last couple laps, but the white flag would be the end if a yellow did come out.
That's absolutely right. You're leading a race like this coming down to the last few laps. You just want to be able to get to that white.
2.4 back.
Telling him the distance back to second, which is the 9 there. That Napa number 9 of Chase Elliott.
The 42 is going to let Chase through. Chase now only a second and a half back.
through 11, 12, and 13. Through 14 and coming to the front stretch. That white flag that you talked about, McDowell getting ready to see it.
Don't look in the mirror, Michael. Just put the lap together.
But the gap is closing.
White flag at the line, bud. White flag at the line.
Here it comes onto the front stretch. One lap to go, presented by Credit One Bank.
But he can see that nine car.
Oh, yeah.
He can look in the mirror and see the nine car, and that raises the intensity just a little bit. He's gotten super conservative on corner entry, trying not to make a mistake.
And Chase the opposite. He's on full aggression that last lap, almost a second better than McDowell.
Yeah, Chase needs this race in the worst kind of way. There's no points avenue for him to make the playoffs. It's a win or nothing.
Smooth here, bud. 12 back.
In the world of stock car racing, Michael McDowell has won at the biggest track of Daytona, and now in the entire world of racing, the most famous track. He's looking for a win here at Indianapolis.
Watch Chase Elliott in this braking zone of turn 11. It's going to be everything he's got.
...12, 13, and 14 in front of him. The final three turns. The gap has closed to a second. Through 14 for the final time. Michael McDowell comes onto the front stretch in Indy. The 38-year-old is going to win at Indianapolis.
Yes. Got more points.
What a day for Michael McDowell. His two wins in the world of stock car racing come at the two most famous tracks in the world. And look at the drivers coming by to congratulate him.
Thanks, guys, so much.
On the radio said, make sure to get my family. So important to him. Wife Jamie, son Lucas, daughter Trace, Emma James, Riley Christine. More drivers going by, giving a thumbs up to McDowell. Again, his career has been a long one. ...453 starts for Michael McDowell. For the early part of his career, it was spent finishing in the 20th to 30th position. Just trying to get the best finishes he could, and now he's won at the Brickyard.
King of the coolest racetracks on the planet, both of them, buddy.
Oh, man, I'm so thankful. Thank you guys so much.
One spot short for Chase Elliott. He had got the gap under a second, but just not enough time. And Michael McDowell didn't make a mistake. Advance Auto Parts. There's the family. He's locked in the playoffs again. Tradition that started with Dale Jarrett after winning the Brickyard 400 here, taking his team to kiss the bricks. Well, Michael McDowell, his family, and his team are going to be able to do that same tradition.
Rick, could you pick two better wins than the Daytona 500 for the first career win and the second one at Indianapolis? It puts him in the playoffs. Michael, as a young man who was coming up through open wheel racing, did you ever dream you would win here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway?
Oh man, this is such a dream come true. I'm so thankful to everybody at Front Row Motorsports, Bob Jenkins, Horizon Hobbies, Love Shop, Soft Freight Auction, Chicago Pneumatic. Man, we had a fast forward Mustang. Everybody at Roush Agents and Shop, Doug, these guys gave me everything today. We had the fastest car. We executed, we did what we needed to do. Just so thankful. So thankful to still be grinding it out in the Cup Series. To put on a performance like that, I don't know if it was dominant, but it felt pretty dominant to me.
Welcome to the playoffs. What were the emotions on those final few laps? Because Chase Elliott was closing quick.
You know, I was really trying to pace myself. I figured there'd be a late race caution. I didn't want to burn my stuff up. So I was just trying to maintain that gap. Then when I got into traffic, started closing, I had to push it. But I just can't believe it. So thankful to Bob Jenkins, all of our partners, Bell Racing Helmets, Sparco. There's so many people that help us. So thankful to everybody that's stuck behind us. It's been a grind, and I'm so proud.
Did you think the path to the playoffs for your team was with a win, and much less, I'll go with dominant as well, a dominant win?
You know, I thought we could point our way in, but after the car that we had yesterday in practice, I thought, man, we got a good shot at winning if we could just get track position and maintain it. I can't believe it. So thankful. Also, Wiley X, I don't know where they're at right now. They should be on my head, but they've been with me for over 10 years, and it's great to have partners like that.
Michael, what does it mean to have the family here to celebrate a win in Indianapolis, a place you always dreamed of just racing at, but it also puts you in the playoffs?
Yeah, it's such a big deal. I mean, you know, winning the Daytona 500 was one of the coolest moments you could ever have. But going to victory lane without your family, that was tough. And so we cherry pick. My family comes to the races. We think we can win. We thought we could win this one. Just so proud.
There you go, Michael McDowell, the emotion. Jamie walks in. He's in the playoffs. He wins at Indianapolis, a place coming up through racing, Rick. He dreamed of racing. Now he's won it. He'll get to kiss the bricks in a moment.
And you see the moment hitting him. He can tell what he's just done. He's accomplished something that very few can say. They have won at Daytona, and they have won at Indianapolis. Michael McDowell, on the most dominant performance of his career, was out front for 54 of the 82 laps. He mentioned it. A dominant performance indeed. Michael McDowell has locked himself into the playoffs with his win here at Indy. The NASCAR America Post-Race Show, presented by Progressive. We'll be simulcasting live on Peacock until 6 p.m., the top of the hour, so plenty of time to hear from drivers. We see multiple coming over to congratulate the 38-year-old out of Glendale, Arizona. Michael McDowell gets his second career win, and it comes at Indianapolis. Girls, the son also coming over to grab that checkered flag to help him out. So we mentioned that this could shake up the playoff standing. Let's take a look. He came in 3 points below that cut line, but with a win, his name is now in yellow. He is locked into the playoffs, and Bubba Wallace now only 28 points above the cut line.
Yeah, so Bubba and Daniel Suarez are in a really tight points battle. Two races, 28 points. But the concern for Bubba is Ty Gibbs, Chase Elliott, Alex Bowman. They're heading to Watkins Glen, and I think they're thinking victory lane is a must. Suarez probably thinks he can make some off points, but a victory is, if he runs anywhere near as fast as he ran here, Suarez has to be one of the favorites heading to the Glen as well.
And just moments ago, Chase Elliott, who's now 19th on this board, finished second today. Dave caught up with him.
I want to charge Chase Elliott put on today only to come up second. What more did you need?
Just be a little better, a little better through the back half over there, and get off of 14 a little better, just to get my have myself in a better spot getting into one. So just really appreciate the effort, man. Our Napa Chevy was really good, really good. Just needed just a little bit more, and came up a bit short. But congrats to Michael, man. He did a good job. ran a great race and stayed mistake free, and that's what you got to do to win.
I was going to ask, you know, what's that like chasing him down like that, knowing one mistake and you can have it?
Yeah, I lost too much ground under that pit cycle and was trying to pace myself for the long haul. It kind of had that green flag feel. So, and I thought I did that. Just needed to do a better job getting through traffic there.
How about Chase the driver? 77 laps under green. Haven't seen that here. What was that like?
It was great. Feel good. Ready to go for 77 more.
All right. We'll see if we can get that next week at Watkins Glen for Chase.
Daniel Suarez comes home in the third position after having a very strong car today. You guys had an issue on pit road where the hose was under the car. How do you come to terms with that and what happened?
I mean, we win and we lose as a team. And that's all I can say. You know, the guys brought a very fast race car. I felt that maybe we were one adjustment behind in the first run with the back of the car, but then we made it a little bit better. But I felt like I was always one step behind the 9 and the 34. And then at the end, I felt that when my car came alive again, we had that issue. So just a little bit of, you know, heartbreaking, but that's part of the sport, you know. All we can do is continue to push, continue to build race cars like these that are capable of winning races. I can thank everyone at Trihard Racing, all the sponsors, Freeway Insurance, all the people that help us to perform this way.
You won the pole here. You had a dominant car. What's the outlook and optimism headed to another road course next weekend?
No, I mean, definitely we can perform, I think, even better. I feel like yesterday we were very strong, and today we're strong. We're lacking a little bit. I didn't like my first half of the race, but I'm pretty sure we're going to go back, analyze everything, and come back stronger next week.
And, of course, Daniel Suarez is going to be a favorite when we go to Watkins Glen, along with Chase Elliott, who finished up here inside the top three. I think the amazing thing that we saw was nearly 2 hours of green flag racing. There wasn't a caution since after lap 6 when the restart happened from that first caution.
Yeah, only one caution today, but I still was entertained. A lot going on out on the racetrack, a lot of battles, disagreements, a lot of frustrated drivers, a lot of smoke, damaged cars, and a Cinderella story or an upset win, if you will. I know that Michael McDowell and that team's gotten so much better, but I don't believe that anybody thought after losing their crew chief at the end of the year, their crew chief, Blake, going to HMS, I thought it would hurt them a little bit. They're stronger. They're even better. They're going to, for the first time in the history of that team, point their way into the playoffs just on performance without the win today. That's incredible for that team. So hats off to them. They've done an amazing job, and they've made that points battle at the bubble even more critical.
A huge win for that team. But what I saw today is there's two drivers that are in position going to Watkins Glen that can win that race and race themselves also into the playoffs. Chase Elliott and Daniel Suarez both. They both had a ton of speed today, ran top four all day long. So even though they're disappointed they didn't get this win, that gives them a ton of confidence going to Watkins Glen next week that they can win there.
Well, the style of racing has become, you know, double fire restarts and overcoming mistakes. It's kind of exciting at times to see one go the opposite. It was about being perfect all day long. You heard Chase Elliott. He was talking about decisions he made 20, 30, 40 laps before the finish of this race. So for Michael McDowell getting his second career in this fashion, the Daytona 500 will always be the premier event, right? He'll always remember that. But he came here, and from start to finish, he just proved that he was the best car on track today.
Let's hear from fourth place Tyler Reddick. Just moments ago, he was with Dave.
Tyler Reddick had the best Toyota today, and fourth place for you. How big a challenge was that?
Honestly, the beginning of the race, we weren't really ourselves, unfortunately. Our SiriusXM Toyota Camry TRD just didn't take off good the first, I'd say, 15, 20 laps of the race, and we lost some track position from that. And I don't know, from that point on, we kind of got better by stage two on and started to go right back, back in the right direction. But I could get right up to Suarez, and I would kind of stall out. I could actually get within 1.5 and dive bomb it in there and try and pass him. But he'd have the preferred group for the next corner, so it just didn't really work out better than him, but just couldn't really go anywhere once we were at his back bumper.
Do you know why it wouldn't take off? I mean, you do something similar next week. Do you have an idea as to what y'all can fix?
Yeah, we'll talk about it, but at the moment, no. No idea.
This place is historic. Your runs here have been good this year. You seem like you had more caught up through practice and qualifying. Do you feel like, except for that first run, you could have really had a good day?
We had the pace. Ultimately, we just kind of fell a little bit behind in the beginning and just needed to be ahead of Suarez, and it could have been interesting to see if we could have closed the gap to the lead cars, but is what it is. We need to run a clean day today, and we didn't really.
Take us to next week, Watkins Glen. How about the opportunity there?
Yeah, that one, you know, A lot of the guys that I race against have a lot more experience there than I do, so I'm always playing catch-up when I go there, but Toyotas always seem to be fast when we go to Watkins Glen, so I'm excited to see what we have for pace of our 2311 Toyota Camry. We'll see in a few days.
Another big challenge ahead for Tyler Reddick.
Another opportunity for Reddick. Already has a win, so he's locked into the playoffs, but looking for another victory. We've got plenty more time that we'll be able to talk with drivers and break down what's ahead of these drivers that have made it into the playoffs, as well as the ones that are fighting to get in. NASCAR America Post Race is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Save when you bundle auto, home, or motorcycle insurance. Visit progressive.com. When you win a race, you get that checkered flag sticker that you get to put right above the driver's side door, indicating a race winner. And that also means he is now locked into the playoffs. I think all eyes, when this race started, were fixed on the driver of the 91, Shane Van Gisbergen, as to what could he do to back up what he did in Chicago, winning the first ever street course race in NASCAR. And Marty caught up with him just moments ago.
Well, Shane Van Gisbergen winds up in the 10th position today. Boy, it was rough right from the start, wasn't it? How is this challenge at Indy different than Chicago?
It's tough here because everyone's on it. Everyone knows the track, and there's a lot more room for error. So everyone's racing aggressively. But can't thank the Project 91 guys here enough. The Enhanced Chevy, so much fun to be back. And yeah, just hopefully can do more. Had an awesome battle with Kyle and Chris there. They got the better of me at the end, but battling with those guys was great.
So what did you learn about how Cup drivers race? Because you were kind of out in front of them at the street course. You were in the middle of it all today.
Well, it's aggressive, but it's fair. You know, I put a block on the 48, and then the next corner he just moved me, so I guess I deserve that. But, yeah, the racing was fine. I really enjoyed it, and all the battling, when you go for a move on someone, they give you room, and they expect it back. So, yeah, really cool.
How would you sum up your entire week? Because you ran the Oval at IRP in the Truck Series, which was, you know, a learning lesson, and then also the top 10 here today.
It's been an amazing week. I can't thank Justin Marks and the Trackhouse team enough to give me this opportunity. I learned a lot in the track on Friday night, and then, yeah, just to come here and race again. And although a top 10's awesome, your expectations are high because of the last race, so just have to realize that top 10's still pretty good.
I'll ask you what I asked you after the win at Chicago. What's next? I mean, your team in Australia has already said, hey, you can go if you want to. You've said, I want to be here. Do you see yourself here full-time next year?
I don't know about full-time, but I'm working towards something at least. The team, Triple Eight in Australia, has been really good to me and forthcoming with what I'm allowed to do. So I'm working hard, but I'm here. It's so much fun. I'm having a blast. The fans here are awesome towards me, and all the people too. I'm enjoying it, so really look forward to coming here.
And what a record for SVG. The win and now a top 10 here at Indianapolis.
Yeah, his only two starts in the Cup Series are top 10 finishes, a win, and as Marty said, this 10th place finish today.
I'm super impressed because, much like we said about McDowell, the way this race ran, there was no room for an error. If you made a mistake, it cost you all day long. So two sets of green flag pit stops. He was able to execute. It looked like he lost a little bit, which you would expect versus the guys that have done it a lot. But him and Christopher Bell, guys, SVG and Christopher Bell have battled each other now for, I think, two-thirds of two entire races. It's been fun to watch.
Yeah, and he gained more and more speed as the race went on, running really competitive laps. In the second half of the race, some of the best laps on the racetrack, so the pace is there. But again, I mean, this kind of turned out like everybody might have expected in terms of coming to a racetrack where the Cup guys have experience. He was still able to make a great account of himself, you know, a little bit better qualifying effort, some yellow flags to bunch to fill back up, and he's right in the thick of it.
And I don't think you can take away his influence on Daniel Suarez's race today. When he came, and he's his teammate, and when he came to Chicago, he immediately has speed. And so that opened everyone's eyes. They talked about pre-Chicago, how they were in the sim, they were working, they knew he was going to be fast. There's no way that hasn't moved into the other race car drivers. Daniel Suarez had a real opportunity to win this race today. SVG, you cannot discount a top 10 finish. You can't, you know, I know that it wasn't a win like it was in Chicago. Still a really good effort. And I want to see what his future looks like. I want to see him go through. We know he can compete on the road courses. We know that. I want to see him go through the process to learn how to race on ovals and see what that presents itself. Can he do it? If he has enough time at his age, could he get to this level in Cup, running as many ovals as we do? And we won't know that until we see him over and over and over in lower divisions trying to learn that skill.
You look at the two trophies that Michael McDowell has, a Daytona 500 win and one from Indianapolis. Pretty impressive trophy case for those two. A guy who finished in eighth today, Kyle Larson, standing by with Marty.
Wound up being in eighth place for Kyle Larson, but I think the race really happened in the second run of the day. You flat spotted that one tire. How much did you have to baby the car, Kyle, after that?
Yeah, I made that mistake in the 12 and flat spotted my left front, which I thought would affect my right-handers, which thankfully it didn't because there's more right-handers than lefts, but all the left-handers, I had no grip, so I was really tight. So, yeah, just kind of had to get through that run. I gave up a few positions at the end of it before green flag stops, and we cycled ahead of the 20 and the 91 and kind of just ran the rest of the race there. So it was a tough race. Wish I wouldn't have made that mistake. You know, maybe I end up third or fourth, but glad we were able to salvage the top 10 of it. Still just bummed that I made a mistake like that. You know, we didn't have any cautions to make up for it, but just is what it is. Just got to clean it up a little bit.
You mentioned the no cautions. You guys ran, I think it was around 100 minutes straight. That didn't happen in Cup Series racing anymore. How tough was it behind the wheel today? It was pretty warm as well.
Yeah, it was hot. It was really hot. Temps were hot, and then, you know, your body just starts cramping up a little bit. You know, you're braking heavy into 1 and 7 and kind of cramp up a little bit. So I was thankful that the checkered came out there soon, but would have liked to have it, you know, get bunched up or get a pit sequence to, you know, shake the strategy up a little bit and maybe get a better finish. But all in all, I mean, I'll take the eighth. You know, we're just trying to gain the points that we can to move up a little bit before the playoffs start, just get any bit of playoff points that we can. So just keep fighting for that and you know, try and close out this regular season on a strong note.
To his point, Kyle Larson, fifth at Michigan last week. Solid top 10 today here in Indianapolis.
And remember, the next time that Kyle Larson comes here, he'll be racing in the Indianapolis 500. So that was announced, the paint scheme and everything for Kyle Larson when he comes back.
Yeah, this guy's been busy. Won the Knoxville Nationals last night. Flies out here, unveils the Indy car and the Cup car that he'll race on the same weekend for the double next year. Kyle Larson is doing as much off the racetrack nowadays as he does behind the wheel of a race car, whether it's a winged sprint car or you know, this Indy car. His schedule, I don't envy it. Over the next 12 months, not only just the testing, the sim work that's going to take, on-track activity, but this right here, the extracurricular stuff, unveiling the car, doing the interviews, all the media that will surround this, all of the sponsorship requests, meet and greets that will surround all of this. He is taking on a monster mountain of responsibilities, and it'll be impressive to watch him go through it.
When John Andretti ran the double Indianapolis and the Coke 600 all in the same day, he was the first one to do it. It was a huge deal. It brought a lot of attention to both races, and I think that's what Kyle Larson will do as well. He is, in my opinion, perhaps the world's greatest race car driver. Who else can win races in anything he sits in the way that Kyle Larson can? I can't wait to see the challenge of coming here and racing against the IndyCar guys that are so good at what they do on their backyard in their cars. It's going to be a challenge, but Kyle Larson will bring the right effort to it.
Yeah, but he's just, I mean, we're going to celebrate all of the on-track, the race in Indy, the race at Charlotte, all of that. But what we won't see is everything that goes on behind the scenes that he will have to be a part of. There will be no days off.
It was a great day for Kyle Larson. Chase Elliott was good, Bowman. But William Byron had to do a pass-through, got lucky with the one and only caution, a bunch of field back up, but basically under green from shotgun on the field, drove all the way to 14th. It's one of those runs that a lot of people aren't going to see. You know, not a lot of people will talk about, but that's a pretty impressive speed out of the 24. And with, you know, the Glen next week and then the Roval coming in the playoffs, you just wonder if William Byron's four-win season can't continue on the right note.
And you see the walk being made to that yard of bricks, the start-finish line here at Indianapolis. On the other side of the break, it'll be Marty Snyder and Dale Jarrett. We get ready for Kissing of the Bricks.
Back at Indianapolis, one of the great traditions in motorsports. Time to kiss the bricks for Michael McDowell. Front Row Motorsports, the family there as well. As we continue our coverage here on NBC Sports, also on Peacock as well. So, DJ, if folks want to go mow the lawn, they can, and they can still listen to us. So you and Todd Parrott, your crew chief, invented this tradition, yep, which now Indy 500 winners do, obviously winners at the road course do. What is this moment like as a driver?
Yeah, it brings back a lot of memories, but puts a smile on my face. Just to, you know, we had no idea that this would be something that would continue and become a tradition here. It was just an idea that Todd Parrott and I had, that we wanted to do something different, and you know, taking everybody out there and enjoying this moment. It's just a special moment because this is the most famous speedway in the world.
Yeah.
And, you know, we started something that, you know, gosh, think back how many years ago that was. I mean, that was 1996.
Wow.
And every winner since then has been right there.
So last year, all of the Indianapolis winners who were here at the track, took a picture together. How many of those Indy winners, Mario Andretti to A.J. Foyt, all of them asked you about the kissing of the bricks?
Yeah, you know, it was interesting to talk to them because, you know, some of them didn't really realize exactly when it started. They kind of knew it was me that did it. But I did talk, and we were doing a little feature, and I did get Mario Andretti to kiss the bricks with me once again. So he said, hey, I never got to do that, you know. He said, that's pretty cool that you started that. And Mario, obviously a great ambassador for motorsports, but just a terrific person in general. And so, you know, this is just so cool to see this.
It's a dirty kiss, but it's a good kiss, isn't it, DJ? Here was you in 1996 and Todd Parrott in that moment when you guys decided, hey, not only are we going to win the race, Todd Parrott goes, hey, let's go kiss the bricks. Why not?
Yeah, we, you know, it's something, again, we talked about. I had to pass my teammate Ernie Irvin late in the race, did that, and then the caution came out. You know, I was enjoying victory lane. I'd kind of forgot about what our plan was, and Todd said, hey, remember where we're going. And then we led everybody. It was like everybody just started following us, and that's what we told them. Come on, follow us. We've got an idea. Because no one else had any idea what Todd and I had come up with.
Well, put yourself in Michael McDowell's shoes, DJ. He came up thinking, hey, I'm gonna be an open wheel racer. I'm going to run the Indy 500. That path never worked out for him. Yep. And here he is. I mean, he's won Daytona and now Indianapolis, and this win puts him in the playoffs.
You know, first and foremost, Michael McDowell is such a good person, and you like to see good things happen to good people. He has done everything that he could once he got his foot in the door in NASCAR to continue to be here. I mean, he's, you know, he has struggled. He'll tell you what a struggle it's been. He's had times that he's thought about, you know, should I look at something else? And but he's just continued to battle. We've known, you know, how talented he is and the expertise that he has on road courses and other styles. He's a tremendous race driver, and it's just good to see this happen to him and to this team. I mean, how more perfect could it be that they just signed him to another
absolutely.
Deal? And, you know, that's just perfect timing for all of that to happen. But for this team, we talk about the teams getting in and what the playoffs mean. Doesn't mean any more than to be this team right here and this driver to have won your way in a dominating fashion into the playoffs.
Front Row Motorsports, no doubt an underdog racing. I think it's fair to call them an underdog, DJ. And we, you know, you've seen in NASCAR before underdog teams win. But have you ever seen a dominant win by an underdog team like that?
No, I don't think that I can. As I was watching the race, I was trying to remember and think back to was there a team? And you know, it may be something that I'm forgetting, but I just don't remember anyone with a team that we don't, you know, consider one of the very top tier. And, you know, these people work as hard as anybody else. Sometimes they have to work harder because they don't have as many people and don't have all the resources. But I don't remember then another driver and team just doing it so dominant. I mean, he showed from the very beginning of this race, he intended to take the lead and he intended to control this, and he did exactly that.
Impressive day for Hendrick Motorsports. Three of their cars wind up in the top 10. Alex Bowman with the top five. After the race, Dave Burns caught up with him.
Fifth today for Alex Bowman. And when I talked to Blake Harris this morning, he's like, yep, we can win today. Yep, we could win next week. You've got to have it. How close were you today?
Yeah, just I feel like the middle stage of the race, we fell off a little bit too much. Those guys kind of got away from us. I think we were really fast that last run, just too far behind to make up for it, and then had a little bit of a mechanical issue the last 10 laps or so. So just proud of this Ally 48 team. Honestly, after the last couple months, fifth feels like a win. So obviously we want more, and we want to do all we can to get ourselves into the playoffs, but just trying to run how we should and finish how we should and put together good solid days has been such a struggle. So to come out of here with a solid top five is definitely good.
I'm thinking the battling back you've done after missing, what, three races with a broken back, right? You're so close.
Yeah, I mean, that and the points penalty, there's so many aspects of it. The reality is if we would have run how we should have or run like this since then, we'd have been fine. But, you know, we got crashed at Pocono and Chicago and Michigan, and I crashed it at Atlanta. It's like anytime we're running good, something happens. So just glad to run well today and get it all the way to the finish line.
How about that mechanical? Where did it affect you on track? Everywhere?
Yeah, I think there's just so much rubber buildup that we got some in the throttle linkage and it started sticking. So glad it didn't stick and we got it to the end. But had a couple hairy moments, but we'll figure it out and go to the next one.
And the next one is Watkins Glen. Obviously, you already said you still need that win. Between that and the wild card at Daytona, you'd rather get it done next week, right?
Yeah, I mean, I'll take a win any week, right? Especially at a road course. But, yeah, I mean, I think we'll have a shot at it. I think here in Watkins Glen are by far my weakest road courses. But, you know, Mr. Hendrick and everybody gives us all the tools we need to excel at these places. So, obviously learned since the last time I was here and improved a lot. So hopefully we can do the same at Watkins Glen.
Strong top five today for Alex.
And Chase Briscoe comes home in the sixth position. Chase, you've been vocal about how hard this season's been, what a struggle it's been to finish here this good at your home track. How much of a bright spot is that for the team?
Yeah, for sure a bright spot. You know, kind of kicking myself. I knew yesterday that when I didn't make the final round, it was going to make my life way harder, and it kind of proved itself. I think we were the highest finishing car that didn't make the final round there. So it's crazy how little of those details come down to winning these races or even just competing for the win there. So thought we were good. You know, just when it goes green like that, it's really hard to ever get the track position. But overall, really good day for our highpoint.com Ford. Like you said, we've been needing kind of just a run like that. It's nice for it to come here. And truthfully, the road courses, ever since we went to this next-gen car, have just been a struggle for me. And I felt like we finally found something that kind of gave me that old feel that I had in the Xfinity car and stuff. So looking forward to next week and feel like we can go there and compete as well.
As you look to turn the page and string together consecutive good finishes, what did you learn here this weekend that might help in the future?
Yeah, I think just like I was going back to, just I think we found something in the car, truthfully, under braking. That was the best I've been under braking in this car, really, ever since the inception of it. So I'm excited. You know, truthfully, the last couple times we went road course racing, I haven't been that excited just because I don't feel like I'm that good to win. So now I feel like we have a car that if we can just get a little bit more out of it, we're kind of right on the verge of getting there. So hopefully we can go next week and kind of mess the playoff field up.
Solid finish for Chase Briscoe and this team.
Yeah, Kim, a little bit of a glimmer of hope there for Chase Briscoe, Stewart Haas Racing, 11th at Richmond a couple of weeks ago, DJ, 6th today. And anytime you can do it at your home track, that's always a little good medicine, isn't it?
Yeah, it feels good. And as he pointed out, I mean, they came from a good ways back to get this finish. And so we're seeing improvement with him. Is it too little too late? But he's got two races to do it. As we keep talking about, anybody can go to Daytona, and I say that. You can't just go there.
Yeah, right.
Somebody's going to win the race, and it's easy for a number of these drivers to think that might be their way in. But big improvement with the performance on that side.
As we continue from Indianapolis Victory Lane, the car is still here. We've talked a lot about the driver of the car, but how about the crew chief, Travis Peterson, a young rising star. His first crew chief job, Kim, you've caught up with him by the bricks.
That's right, Marty. And before we get to the team element, the race element of this, your family moved to North Carolina so your dad could work in the sport. Your dad, Tom, he is part of the sport too. For you to get your first win as a crew chief at a place as historic as Indianapolis, what does that mean to you and for your family?
I mean, it's huge, right? I mean, my whole life I've wanted to go win as a crew chief, and to do it here is outrageous. It's like one of the two coolest racetracks in the whole world. You know, I just want to say hi to my parents. You know, thanks for taking the risks you did. Hi to my beautiful, amazing, pregnant wife. I love you. Oh my God, I can't wait to get home and celebrate with you guys. I mean, I'm gonna cry, Kim. Stop making me cry.
So the emotions are showing. You've got to kiss the bricks. Sum up what this day means for this race team. You guys are locked in the playoffs now.
I mean, it's amazing. That was the goal, right? We said we wanted to be in the hunt because we knew we could get a lot of points here. I mean, I knew after last year at Indy how fast we were on the 17 and coming here with Michael's natural ability that it was going to be a great race for us. But, man, I didn't think we were going to be that fast. That was awesome. And to be in the playoffs, to get a win, to be in the hunt the whole time and not be a fluke win, I mean, it's just awesome. Everybody at Front Row, the build that they've seen over the years now, everything Michael's helped build there, everything Jerry and Bob and everybody did. You know, our sponsors, Love's been with us forever. Horizon Hobby on the car today, Freight Auction, all these people, they did an amazing job to keep us going and to help this build.
Michael made it look easy. He was dominant out there, but he had 7-time road course winner Chase Elliott in his rearview mirror. I heard you on the radio. The intensity was ratcheting up, getting your spotter to move the lap cars out of the way. Describe those emotions and what you were thinking in the closing laps.
I mean, I knew the run before that we had held on a little better, but I could see him pushing. You know, he was charging the brake zones, and Michael was pacing himself. I think he knew what he was doing, you know, just saving his stuff for if he did get close to be able to charge it. Obviously, it's huge nerves. Anytime you're in the lead, anytime you know you got the best car, it's waiting for something to happen, waiting for a debris caution, something like that. But, I mean, it was amazing. I was just sitting there. I don't even know. It all went by in a blur.
When we talked a couple weeks ago, you said you were not focused on the playoff races yet. You had to get into the playoffs. You had to focus on the task ahead of you. Now that you have a spot in the playoffs, is it Darlington study when you get home this week? What is the outlook?
No. I mean, Michael's best road course is Watkins Glen, so let's go run it back, right? I mean, Daytona, you got to try to build points now, right? Everything we can do. So Obviously, we're going to put all the emphasis on that. And Michael had a good run at Darlington, and we won Bristol last year. So first round's looking good for us.
Congratulations. Enjoy the win.
Thank you.
Marty, that's Travis Peterson. He mentioned his pregnant wife at home. That's Hannah. They're due mid-September. So to add to the playoff chaos, they're going to be welcoming a new baby to the Peterson family soon.
Yeah, so cool to see the emotion, DJ, right? And you mentioned his dad, Tom, Kim. And he's a longtime Joe Gibbs Racing employee. So cool to see his son in victory lane, no doubt about it. The bubble, DJ, I mean, for Bubba Wallace, he came in looking good. This was absolutely the worst-case scenario for the 23 team.
Yeah, for Bubba above the line, who looked like that he had built a nice little lead, but also for the guys that were below thinking they could still get in on points. And you had Ty Gibbs that came in here 3 points to the good and now quite a bit out of it. So it just shows you how things can be shaken up quickly. And I think, yeah, we could even take this up to where, as of right now, what you saw from Chase Elliott and his team here today, from Daniel Suarez, Kevin Harvick and Brad Keselowski, they might be in a real battle Daytona. If we get one of those guys to win, that should happen to win next week, then that makes for a real battle between Harvick and Brad for that last spot.
Yeah, so if Chase Elliott happens to win, Watkins Glen certainly showed the speed today. That would be a 2-point separation, DJ, going into the final race at Daytona, just 2 races left in the regular season.
Yeah, this is just, I mean, just shows how competitive things are and that each and every week we talk this, and it's not that we're just talking things up, because it just shows the competitiveness and how anything can happen here.
Well, today in the racing capital of the world, it's Michael McDowell going from below the cut line to in the playoffs this year. NASCAR America Post Race Show is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Save when you bundle auto, home, or motorcycle insurance. Visit progressive.com. DJ, let's take a look at this week's Progressive Safe Driver. And I think when you lead well over half the laps in the race, Michael McDowell earned that today, didn't he?
Oh, he certainly did. I mean, that's quite an accomplishment when you can be the fastest and the safest at the same time. But he did a tremendous job.
With 54 laps for Michael McDowell today, he gets the win at Indianapolis, cementing Front Row Motorsports into the 2023 Cup Series playoff field. I love how the family was there too, DJ. The emotion from Michael McDowell having the family there as well. And yeah. I believe in a moment he's going to make his way up to us.
Well, yeah, this is one of those wins that I know I don't believe they were at his Daytona 500
win. We're not there.
Have as many people as you possibly can, especially your family that you know, they give so much for you to do what you love to do and what you're good at, and they sacrifice a lot. So to be here at the world's most famous speedway and enjoy this day, everyone together, it's a great family moment. I can remember having my dad here. He was here in 96 whenever I won. And it's just an incredible, incredible moment.
Your dad, the Hall of Famer, Ned Jarrett, was able to be here for one of your wins. Coming into the race, DJ, everybody thought Christopher Bell was the man to beat. He winds up in ninth. Afterwards, Dave caught up with him.
Ultimately, Christopher Bell was ninth today. Felt like you had a better car than that to start the day. Where did the day go?
Yeah, it was just kind of the way it played out. And I don't know, after the last couple weeks, I'm really happy that. I feel like we finally put a race together. So hopefully can build on that and do a little bit better at Watkins Glen and carry that into the playoffs.
Do I hear strategy coming out there? Because you're one of the latter ones to pit of the leaders.
Yeah, I mean, we're just trying to split the tires and put equal stints on each tire. And the fall off wasn't there, and the guys who pit first got out front.
And that was one of the issues, was your fall off was pretty great?
Well, it wasn't good. Well, everyone else needed to have a little bit more fall off. So whenever you're the first one to pit, you don't want your tires to fall off, and they didn't. So we just got buried, and not buried, but a couple guys got in front of us, and that was it.
All right, top 10 for Christopher Bell.
Solid day for Christopher Bell. Honored to have the Indianapolis winner here with us, Michael McDowell. Man, I mean, I asked you out there, did you expect a win to get you in, but much less for it to be that dominant, Michael?
You know, yesterday practice went so good. I'll be honest with you. I was so anxious this morning because I thought we had a car that could win. And I don't know that I've been in too many of those spots where we were so strong in practice that I felt like, man, if our car is as good as it was, you know, yesterday, I think we have a shot at winning. And it just made me nervous. It really did. And, you know, once the race started, I just got into the zone and got into my pace. And those first 3 laps, I'm like,
I think I got it. I think I have what it takes, you know. Car was doing all the things that we needed to do, but then you get battling and it gets heated, and you know, the 99 got in front of us there on pit road, and I knew I was a little bit quicker than him, but he was so good in the brake zones, I just had a hard time passing him. So, you know, it was a great race. It's a humbling sport. Been grinding it out a long time. Yeah. And we've been building on our road course program at Front Row. It's not like a super shocker to us, because we've been a top three to top five car most of the next gen races at the road courses. And we just keep building on the platform that we have. And, you know, I'm really proud of Travis Peterson and everybody at Front Row. We had the car to win today. We executed and we did it. And you dream of days like that.
Yep.
And but it was a hard race. I mean, I pushed as hard as I could push, trying to make sure that I had a gap, because I knew Chase Elliott, he's the best at road racing. So to beat him is super special. It's just a great day. I don't even know what to say. It's just amazing.
Michael, it was such a dominating performance that you put, but with the long laps that are here, I mean, you've got a lot of turns, a lot of shifting. How much longer did those last 10 laps seem to take? And were you looking in the mirror, or were you just looking at what you had to do out in front of you?
I was paying attention to the gap a little bit. But honestly, I was just trying my best to push hard in the brake zones, not too hard, and hit my marks. And a few laps that I felt like I needed to go a little harder, I made mistakes. And I'm like, okay, my pace is good. I need to do what I can do, not try to do any more, and just don't make any mistakes. Because he wasn't catching us at a rate where he would have got to us unless I made a mistake.
Yep.
Now, the traffic made me nervous for sure, but we were able to navigate through that, you know, well. And then as we got the 10 to go and he wasn't catching too much, I really started to conserve a little bit because I thought there might be a yellow, right? It's
yep.
Not very often you run a whole cup race without a yellow near the end. And I'm like, if he's back there saving his tires and I'm flogging it up here and we get a caution and he beats me, I'm going to be in trouble. So I started backing down a little bit, but then with five to go, once he got under 2 seconds, I'm like, don't let him get too close. You know, don't give him that opportunity to get to you. So it was methodical. It was hard. But we had a really fast Ford Mustang. So just what an amazing day to be able to go out there and lead a lot of laps. That's my first stage win, too.
Yeah, I know. It's the first team's first stage win.
I think it's so funny because, you know, without the stage breaks, we knew that we would have a shot at winning a stage and scoring points. So it's worked out so well for us this year without having a stage break. So, yeah, just a great day. I mean, everything went perfect. We did a great job on pit road, executed all day. And I mean, to win at Daytona and now win at Indy, it's like, yeah. I'm cherry picking. I'm picking the best races. So
hey, you couldn't pick two better, could
yeah.
you?
No. So
I want to talk about the significance of Indy. You were coming up to the Champ Car, IndyCar route. I mean, you thought you were going to run the Indy 500
yeah.
someday. Did you ever dream, though, that this moment would happen here with this race team, that you could win at Indianapolis?
No, I mean, I really didn't. You know, I think that growing up, you know, I was open wheel guy. You know, I even got inducted into the Road to Indy Hall of Fame. And
yes, you did.
And, you know, I only got to do a handful of IndyCar races, but never here. And so I remember my first Brickyard here thinking, well, this wasn't the plan. You know, like, this is not what I thought I would be. But I'm so thankful to have had the career I've had in NASCAR and to make the transition. But this place, to me, is so special. I mean, I know our sport, Daytona, is special. Nothing will ever top that. I don't want to take anything away from that. But growing up, for me, it was Indy. I mean, this is what it was. And I mean, we'd come on a summer vacation and ride the white vans around here and tour the museum and ride around. You know, it's such a special place. So to win here is amazing. And, man, it's humbling. The sport is so humbling in a good way. Good ways and bad ways. You have good weeks and bad weeks. But to be in victory lane and to be talking to you guys after having such a performance today is just unbelievable.
Well, welcome to the playoffs, Michael McDowell. It's going to be a fun one. And the 10 weeks of pressure just starting, by the way.
Yeah,
coming
no,
up
I
in
know.
A couple weeks of
hey,
playoffs.
I feel relieved. The pressure might
I'm
go
sure
up, but
do.
Right now I feel pretty relieved.
There you go. He's in the playoffs for sure. Doesn't count points anymore. Don't have to worry about points anymore. Michael McDowell and the McDowell family in victory lane here at Indianapolis. Plenty more to come from IMS.
We're back at Watkins Glen International.
Hell yeah, baby! Woo!
The atmosphere around the racetrack is almost like a Talladega infield.
One of the biggest parties in NASCAR.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, yes!
I feel like there's action at every corner.
They're beating on each other really hard ahead, stay on your toes.
It's the fastest road course we go to.
Atta baby, good corner, drive off.
Just tons of speed and a very tight track.
Passing opportunities are everywhere.
If anybody's around that area, they definitely need to come check it out.
DJ, I don't know about you. I had fun at the road course today. Why not do back-to-back? Watkins Glen next week.
Perfect, yeah. And don't think that we're going to go through that one caution-free. There's going to be a lot of contact, a lot of urgency.
That race will be broadcast radio style both Saturday and Sunday. So exciting. It'll be all on USA from Watkins Glen next week. Just two races left in the regular season before the playoff field is set. And you can see the times for next week. 2:30 on Sunday is when Countdown to Green kicks off. So I want to talk about Chase Elliott. Finishes second today, DJ. So if you're a Chase Elliott fan, are you upset about today or are you encouraged by the speed they brought here?
Oh, I think you have to be encouraged. I mean, you know, they just got beat today by a better driver and car, and there's no denying that. And I said while ago it was caution-free. It wasn't. I know we had one early on. Chase could have used one there at the end. I don't know if he had anything, but we know how good he is. But I would be very encouraged by what I saw, knowing the style of what that track brings, how it's more high speed along the way, and it obviously it's a place that he's won at before. So he knows how to get the job done. So I think they go there with a lot of confidence, thinking now it's their turn to win their way into the playoffs.
Not only has he won there before, DJ, he got his first career win. This was 2019. He's won there twice.
Yeah, and it's just so good. Now I realize, you know, we talked about it, those wins that he has, those seven road course wins, were in the other car. But he proved today just how good he can be. It's just sometimes you're as good as you can be, which was outstanding, and sometimes there's just somebody that's a little bit better. So I'm not going to be surprised to go there, watch him possibly sit on the pole, but he's going to definitely be a factor in the race and the outcome of the race.
And talking to their team this morning, they actually said going into the race today, finished the second, going into the race today, they felt better about next week at Watkins Glen because you mentioned it, DJ, all the speed, and that's certainly going to play to Hendrick Motorsports' advantage.
Yeah, there's no doubt that there's some things that are there, that the way that you have to drive that track and what goes on, and having the confidence of winning there is going to go a long way. So it's going to be very interesting to watch all of that transpire, and don't count out Daniel Suarez, who was outstanding here today also.
I was going to bring up Daniel Suarez, Alex Bowman with the top five. I mean, the pressure, DJ, these drivers are going through with just two races left in the regular season. Put yourself in their shoes. What are they thinking this week as they get ready to go to Watkins Glen?
Yeah, you spend every waking moment thinking, what can I do to be better? You know, is it more time in the simulator, more time in the shop? You know, when we get there, I have to do everything and give every bit of the information. You know, we know they don't have a lot of practice, so you do what you can there and then give your best effort, but you know that time is running out.
Yeah, you know time is running out, and you also know, DJ, you don't want to leave it to Daytona, that crazy last race of the regular season where literally anybody could win. You don't want to leave it, that being your final opportunity to get in the playoffs.
You'd prefer that not be the case, but, you know, it's going to be the case for more than what it's not. So, you know that you do have that in your back pocket, but you would certainly like to get it out of the way next week.
Yeah, what a day here at Indianapolis, the world's most famous race course. A lot of beating and banging and then a long run to the end. But at the end of the day, it was Michael McDowell that wound up getting the win over Chase Elliott and Daniel Suarez. That last pit stop, they'll think about that for a while on the 99 team. More NASCAR motorsports coverage always available on NBCSports.com. Come up next on NBC, your local news except on the West Coast.